RCTV, and that's channels 99 Comcast and 32 Verizon. And the first item on the agenda is notice of intent 278, it doesn't have a DEP number yet, parcel 0, Haverhill Street, map 57, lot 17, Gillis. And this is a notice of intent. The public hearing is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act. Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, is amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing is conducted the following manner. Applicant will present the proposal. Commission will receive reports from administrator, tech advisors, and other town departments, and commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. And the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions, which you should direct to the chair. And when you do that, please give your name and address before your comments or questions are presented. And did everyone sign in back? There's a sign-in sheet. So, okay. Oh, I'd like to introduce members of the commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Troney, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Al Couillard.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
David Pinnett.
Hi, good evening. I'm Jim Corbin with Stamsky and McNary, and I'm here with the applicant, John Gillis. Thank you for the opportunity to present. The applicant proposes to build a single family dwelling on this parcel here, which is at the corner of Batchelder Road and Haverhill Street, near the North Reading town line. There's bordering vegetated wetland on the southern portion of the property, which projects a 100-foot buffer zone through the entire northern portion of the property. That's why we're here today. The included with a single-family dwelling is an attached single-bay garage, associated driveway, and patio area. Because of the proposed project's proximity to the wetland, several mitigation measures are proposed to both protect the wetland and reduce the roof runoff during a storm event. Those include a roof drain trench at these portions of the side of the house, shown here in red, as well as rain barrels, 55-gallon rain barrels, that will be part of the downspout system before the it's intercepted at the ground. And for the driveway, a drip edge as well. The driveway will be graded such that water will sheet off the driveway towards that portion, towards that drip edge. For this project, there's proposed 25 trees to be cut in the upland area here. To replace those, to get to the one-to-one ratio required by the town's tree replacement policy, there's 10 trees here proposed to be planted, as well as 12 Edwish blueberries in the 25-foot area buffer zone, and an additional 35, I believe, other shrubs that are associated with the invasive species management program that was developed by David Crossman for this project. Again, because of the project proximity to the wetland, and its vegetation within the buffer zones, a variance is required, and a variance is requested.
Jim, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Did you meet the one that puts one of those trees?
We do now, yes, with the additional 12.
Great.
Shrubs. The applicant hereby requests the following waivers. Number one, waivers for 25-foot zone of natural vegetation. The waiver is required to perform the work described, withdrawing from a buffer around the Finger Lake projection of the DDW. You'll see here, this line is the wetland line, and there are three flags that project a finger to the north. And withdrawing from my buffer around the Finger Lake projection, the BBW between wetland flag 2R and 2C, it's not legible on here, would allow for the the Finger Lake buffer based on projection of wetland flags 1 and 6, excluding wetland flags 2A and 2B, would allow for the project to be developed as described, while still protecting the BVW, the wetland, in the interests of the town of Reading's wetland protection regulations. Waiver request variance number 2. A waiver is required to perform the work described. Similar to the waiver 1, this waiver would still allow for the project to be developed as described, while still protecting the BVW in the interests of the town of Reading's protection, wetlands protection regulations. And included with that is a alternative analysis for those two waivers and for the proposed structures.
Can I ask, you're not just inside the 35-foot line, right? You're inside the 25.
As projected by that finger, that wetland finger coming up, yes. Not by structure, but by the project grading needed for the structure.
Okay, so the structure is outside of the...
Correct.
Outside of the 25.
Yes, there is a portion, I shouldn't say
that's
that.
That's
not there
what
is
I
a,
see.
That's, yeah.
No, from the finger, that it is in the 25 foot. Well,
yeah. Okay.
Of the finger's 25-foot radius.
Yes, excuse me, there's none within the 35. Oh, no, there is as well. The project proposes the alteration of 1,000 square feet of land within the 25-foot buffer. This dotted line right here is the 25-foot buffer. And what the waiver is requesting is to bring that buffer to this area here, as would be projected by the wetland, excluding this area. However, the buffer still protects that Finger Lake projection. Those also to improve the health of the wetland. There's proposed replacement of invasive species within the wetland, the buffer zone, and some of the upland as well. And those are outlined in the invasive species management program.
Jim, do you have plans to, if you remove that wetland area, are you replacing it somewhere on the site?
The wetland will not be touched.
The finger?
Correct.
You're gonna leave it there?
Yes.
Okay. Just want us to ignore.
And that's what I'm trying to convey.
So we're trying to ignore the buffer aspect of it?
as that finger would project, not ignore, but challenge its significance to the wetland as a whole.
So, could you explain that a little bit more when you say challenge the significance to the wetland as a whole?
Well, if you notice the shape of this wetland, and as it continues out, you can see from town maps as well, the wetland has a pretty well-defined line going up, and as delineated per the ANRAD, except for this little finger right here, with a buffer zone from that finger, this project is very much diminished. And with the mitigation measures that we include with this project, while still protecting that wetland area with a limit of work in the plantings, it's we feel very strongly that the whole wetland will be not only protected but improved, including that finger. However, we do request that buffer zone around that finger-like projection be reduced to be an assumed buffer from these two wetland flags here, as well as the rest of the wetland.
And so, could you summarize the mitigation again that you were talking about?
Right. So, as far as the structure is concerned, we're proposing to keep the structures outside of these now assumed 25-foot buffer and 35-foot buffer, except for a small portion of patio here and trench here. Out of that 35-foot buffer zone and the 25-foot buffer, as well as pretty significant drip edges here. They're not just drip edges. They're 2 feet deep by 3 feet wide, completely filled with crushed stone and stretching the length of the structure. And there's three of them here. That with the rain barrels and in the driveway trench, that'll take care of any roof runoff. Now, as far as disturbance of ground and loss of vegetation, with replacement of invasive species with more native, thank you, species, and the tree plantings, as well as removing a leaf litter area, that wetland's health will be improved.
As far as the square footage that's going to be inside the 35-foot zone, do you have those numbers?
Those areas?
Yeah, so how much structure, so we've got...
Yes, I do. That's on the second page of the narrative. The project proposes the alteration of 1,080 square feet of land within 25 foot of the resource area, and another 427 square feet of structure within the 30... Excuse me, that number was changed to include the patio. So that's 491 square feet of structure within the 35-foot, within 35 feet of the resource area.
Those numbers are for recognizing that finger, or for
that is yes.
That's for recognizing that finger.
Yes.
And what was the number in the 25 zone of natural vegetation? 25 foot.
1,080 square feet.
Existing, the pump station, the electric cabinet and foundation.
That's not on the property, that's in the right of way.
Oh, I see. So that's
yes.
The right of way.
But you're correct, it's a sewage pump station.
It's a sewage pump station for the town.
Yes, that's currently being constructed to replace the old pump station that was there existing.
Madam Chair, can I comment?
Sure.
Okay. I think from my perspective, I just want to give you my own feedback. The level of care with the planning and the trees, showing where all the trees are and what kind they are and what girth, and the plans are in really good shape and they're looking really good to me. From a wetlands perspective, I understand why this project is being proposed and I understand the intent of the applicant, but to me, the deal breaker for me is literally having structure within the 35-foot. That's been a press.
35 or 25?
35 no build zone that this commission has stuck with as long as I've been on it. That's over 10 years. It's crazy. And we've really been, and we've seen buffer zones, the 100-foot buffer zones, habitat diminish time and time and time again. And in my opinion, this 35-foot line is, you know, in some towns, they say you can't touch within 100 feet of a wetland. And clearly, Reading doesn't have that practice. There's, you know, when you look just about anywhere in town, if we said 100 feet, you can't build within a wetland. It would be a lot of houses would get taken out of Reading, and so that's not realistic for Reading. So in people's practical wisdom in conservation, my understanding is they came to this 35 foot as a, you know, we keep getting asked for people to build closer and closer and closer to the wetlands, and this 35 foot is really where we're gonna say you can't build now. There are alternatives, including changing the house size. I mean, we've had people propose, literally build like almost right along the 35-foot line, and then cantilever a couple feet, like so there was no foundation, into even further toward the wetland, and some of those projects, you know, we've approved. And I saw in your narrative that that it was your opinion that without putting a house like this on the property, that it's basically undevelopable. And I disagree with that point. I think thinking creatively,
One thing I have to stress is we're 8 feet from property lines here.
The
front, that, you know, that's right. 18 feet. Enough to park a vehicle.
I see how tough a lot this is. Because I've seen situations like this before. I'm cognizant of, you know, all other setbacks and restrictions and stuff like that. It just seems to me that in a lot of permitting situations, and this is my observation and maybe it's my bias, but it seems to me that in a lot of situations, people are looking to get what they want to get out of the lot, and that's their right to do. I don't fault you for that at all. But it seems like the wetlands line is the line that everyone's asking to get a break on. You know what I mean? And for me, the 35 is the 35. So I would not be in favor of this project because of the 35.
Do you?
Nico, hold. So I would just say, Nico, I think there have been projects before us where people have crossed the 35-foot line with a structure, but it's been a small corner or a shed. It's been 33 feet.
But we're talking.
No, I agree. I just want to put it into perspective that we have seen it cross before. We haven't been asked for a variance for it to cross before, but it's been a matter of 2 feet, a matter of a very minimal distance.
A temporary shed that is on cinder blocks and doesn't disturb the ground and allows for root growth under there. That's one thing. And some of those sheds have been grandfathered in. They were there, you know, and nobody knew about it until the permit was proposed. Okay, but this is a treed lot and brand new construction.
I would agree that this is to a different degree than what we've typically seen.
I have a question. Have you considered, I think Anika's right, this is a lot to ask of me, but 35, and I've only been here a couple of years, but I haven't seen it either. But did you investigate the possibility of filling that finger, and is there enough room on the side lot line to replicate and still stay 35 feet off the side of that house?
Yes, that was considered, absolutely. How is that any better, though, than this? Where
because
the wetland is still
variance in the, we don't have to set the precedent. I hate saying that word, but we don't have to.
Well,
we
I
don't have to vote on something that's so far in the 35.
I left you an out for that, with the way where
well,
the variance.
A lot of people have tried to leave us an out, and we haven't taken it in a long
to
time.
Not set a precedence. Correct. This is this wetland right here. That's 3 feet on top.
Yeah.
To come down to, I believe, only 16 feet.
Yeah.
It's absolutely a finger-like projection.
I see it. I get it.
So you don't want to protect, you want to just ignore it. I mean, that's
no,
a very
I'm protecting it. With the limit of work and the proposed...
No. The idea of a buffer is to protect it.
Let me ask you this. Do you feel the wetland is not protected with...
If we get
as the project is proposed?
If we get inside the buffer, yes, I do. I mean, I think we have this 35-foot structure line for a reason.
How would filling a portion of wetland...
Jim, what's the square footage of the finger?
3 by 16.
It's less than 150 square feet? Yeah.
Well,
it's
I'm
under,
actually
it's certainly under 300.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work in the wetland to...
150 square
that's
feet.
What we were trying to eliminate doing was
that's
to be working in the actual wetlands by filling in that.
I don't want to see it filled either. I mean,
actually,
I was
just
but you
for
could.
The possible alternative.
I think that's not an unreasonable idea, and I think you could do it. I see where you did the 35 feet without that finger.
Mm-hmm.
If you flattened it out, not flattened it, but paralleled the line of the regular wetland more towards Haverhill Street, you might be able to get that 150 square feet in there.
And this is...
So what's the distance on
you
the
know what I'm saying?
Line?
So that, I mean, the little
like
finger
this.
Is approximately, I mean, I ballparked it. I ballparked 150
because
square feet. The house footprint itself is, I mean, this is very rough, but I calculated 1484 square feet just for one story. So you can shrink that house footprint two stories and still make it a very marketable house.
Portion of that area that you're calculating is
garage
and porch.
Some of us don't have garages in town. I mean... I'm just saying, you know, you don't have an ideal lot to build. You got to live with those constraints.
Well, you've just suggested, though, filling the wetland. Let's say we...
I don't know that everybody's suggesting that.
No, we haven't
considered.
We didn't suggest it.
It was mentioned. And there's... So, let's say we do. We fill in this area here and add 2 feet all along that. That's requiring equipment to go within this whole area here that right now won't be touched.
Can I make a suggestion that's more simplistic? You took that trapezoid and just flipped it this way towards Haverhill Street.
I think that's what everybody's
okay.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You would then, again, now we're talking about going in and disturbing that wetland and replicating it. And and you would be outside the 35-foot zone.
Completely with the building.
And you'd be able to build what you have there now without encroaching on the 35, no build zone. One of the other things I want to make is a point here, is that that finger that comes out there was not part of the original.
Dave, just so everybody's on the same page, where are you talking about?
Right there, just flip it this way.
If it were moved,
take that.
If it magically were moved.
And flip it this way.
A straight line that goes like this or something.
Well, that horizontal line, just flip that so that it's up against Table Street.
Like this.
Yeah.
If you take that whole thing that's there and just flip it down this way, 180 degrees.
I don't know how the rest of the board feels, but I think the replication plan is fine. If you're gonna work in the wetlands and fill and replicate, you have a nice plan like this with all the right replication.
Stop saying fill the wetland, if replication plan for, to get closer.
I'm not sure I see it.
Because it's just for a benefit.
I see that, I don't know if that's sufficient.
You don't want.
If you take this right here.
Give a two to one.
Don't just go filling something just because.
Well, if you have to replicate it, two to one.
If you take this here and flop this down this way.
I don't know if it's sufficient to give 2-to-1 replication. We don't have that data. We don't have that data.
If you have this down here and then come back to here, I think you do have it.
I do too.
But they could figure that out, or you could put it in another place as well.
Yeah, I mean, it's not our job.
It's commission's job to figure it out.
Not our place to decide, but.
But if you did it out here, I mean, you could just reach over with your equipment.
Yep.
It would be less.
Yeah, minimum. You don't have to go all the way up this line and up this room.
Be less invasive.
Just impact this area right here.
I don't see how that's any less invasive than what's proposed. I don't see how that protects the well.
We're trying to tell you that it doesn't look good for this much intrusion into the 35-foot no disturb. Well, it doesn't want to go that way.
I think it's, we haven't seen a variance like this been given for a project. I don't know that anybody on this commission.
You did mention that variances have been given for structures within the 35.
You're right. For something that has gone.
Minimal.
No. Right in a corner. 33 feet, the square footage is not 491 square feet. It's been nowhere close. I think what this commission is saying is that there's ways to get creative and to make this work, and there's ways that this commission would be open to seeing something here, but I currently see it's not quite there.
I feel the same. I think it's a good plan. I think you're on the right track, but the amount of structure inside the 35 no disturb is overwhelming for us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
by eliminating the that wetland finger, that's going to reduce the 35-foot line. So everyone agrees to that, and then this project works. So the options are flip it or find a spot on the other side and recreate it. Would you guys consider, we all saw that leaf pile that matted down, that is not a wetland anymore, that's a pile of leaves. If they redevelop that area back into a wetland, would that satisfy the commission?
That's what our intent was for this.
Can
that's
you
already
please indicate on a plan that
yes,
area
clarify what's going
so
on
I can
there.
See
yeah,
it?
Just a little bit. I think you'll zoom out a little bit. It's the red hashed area,
that,
right?
That's
right in this area. Here. It's rather a large
not,
area.
Not
and that's already part
as
of
the
impact.
And that's an up.
Some
it's not wet.
Skunk cabbage has forced its way above.
And it's adjacent to the wetland.
8-10 inches of leaves on it. It's been there.
Does it matter if it's contiguous?
Big area.
It is contiguous.
All that
it is contiguous.
Yeah.
Okay.
Could we switch the wetlands invasive species management program plan? I just want to show. The measures we've taken to try to improve this wetland.
I didn't put that on this zip time.
Okay, that's fine. If you have your packets with you, you should all have it. Second to last page.
I know, where's the bad
sorry.
Time?
Sorry.
Wait, this is modified.
Halfway plan, and I wasn't going to
hear
it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great.
Second to last page, you said?
Mm-hmm. You'll see here, we went through and located every single invasive plant on the property and developed a plan to remove those, prevent them from growing back again, and reestablish that those areas with native plants. That with the leaf litter area, I don't know if you're gonna find another applicant that's gonna undertake that much measures to improve the wetland.
So can I ask a question on this back side here? Do we have an idea of the wetland ends on the back side at some point? I know it wasn't delineated in the back side, usually because there's no...
Correct. So, correct.
Right.
That's why we didn't delineate, because our part of the project was
gonna
based
be
on the opposite,
yeah,
side.
Opposite side of
correct.
It.
Correct.
Yeah.
If you want an idea of what it looks like, though, the back left corner, or the southwest corner, that's all wetland. But if you get up towards Haverhill Street and the Melanson property, on that side of the lot line, there's fill material for their driveway that extends onto the property by just a few feet. But it creates a bank, so at the bottom of that bank, you can assume that's where the wetland approximately will start.
Can you show that on that?
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is the neighbor's driveway.
Right.
And there's an iron pipe here and a line of shrubs, as well as a fence. You can assume it's the property line, and I verified that. Just a few feet beyond that, it drops. And that's where that leaf pile is.
Right.
And several skunk cabbage in that area.
One of the other things that I want to also bring up too, just from my recollection, is that when Wetland Flag 2A was placed, it was agreed at that time to just join Wetland Flag 2A to Wetland Flag 2R. But that from 2A back to the intersecting line between Wetland Flag 2C and Wetland Flag 2R, that lower end was never really delineated in a very accurate fashion. So that bottom edge of that trapezoid might actually be more of a rectangle than a trapezoid.
On that southerly side of it?
Yes.
On the easterly side of that, that's correct.
Northwesterly side, correct.
We were mainly focused on Wetland Flag, like you said, 2B
right.
and 2C.
Because that depression kind of looks to me like when you're walking through the woods and you see something that's been logged off, an old skidder track. That's what it looks like in the ground. Just like a tire depression.
Right, but we do have an ANRAD that we
right.
approved.
We did.
So that is the line.
Yeah,
the line.
Can I just ask, so I have it in my head here, because I think I can see the line. If the commission were to say there's enough here to be enough mitigation to either replicate some additional wetland or whatever, and the finger section of this was ignored, how much crosses the 35-foot line at that point for structure? Is it just the patio?
Just a couple feet of patio, which that can be reduced or turned to grass.
The
house is outside.
It meets the corner of the corner of the house meets the 35
yeah, yeah,
foot
yeah.
line.
I think there's like a 6-inch.
The corner does meet.
Just
okay.
Close
yep.
to it.
Got it.
Right on it.
Oh, I see the line.
I think that counts as a margin of error.
Yeah, I think.
I mean, it looks like it's right on the line.
But this area, yeah.
But so it's really
not change.
It's really just the patio.
Patios, yeah.
It's less
patio.
Than 60 square feet.
Okay.
56, I think.
I just want to make sure that's.
And if that's.
I think that's a number that this, at least myself, would be more willing to live with.
We can eliminate the patio.
As long as we can find.
I'm sorry, what?
We can eliminate the patio portion that's in the 35 foot buffer zone at that point. That's. We could turn it to grass, you know what I mean? If that
mm-hmm.
makes the commission lean one way or another. Or reconfigure if it makes the commission lean one way or another, you know. which is something we had put down, and we didn't realize till recently that the patio was considered structure.
Right, we had that discussion.
Yes, on the site visit.
Right, yeah.
So.
Yeah, in their defense, they had thought it was not structure.
It's a
difficult process to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So at this point, you said there might be some skunk cabbage over by the leaf litter lawn clipping area?
Oh, there definitely is, yes.
There definitely is. So that area might actually be really prime to wetland replication.
Well,
yeah.
It's
leaf area.
Yeah.
Problem
I mean,
with that.
Something to consider.
Is it wetland? You know,
is it wetland already?
It's a little wetland.
Well, no, not necessarily. No, there's a slope that he said it was coming down from the driveway. It was pretty steep, and then it's a leaf litter pile. Chuck, you were looking at it, and you were pulling stuff up the other day. You think that leaf litter area is wetland?
Well, kind of how I'm thinking about it is there's a wetland that's this wetland finger, as you guys have been talking about. And it either needs to be ignored, which we have never done, or replicated 2-to-1. And there's a prime spot where the leaf litter is, whether they have to dig or they don't have to dig. They just have to remove leaves to recreate that. They might have to move it forward so it meets the wetland, but there's a spot on the other side to do this. Mm. So that's what I was bringing up.
Yeah.
And if you would accept that spot, because we really didn't look at it. It's
right.
Probably lower than, you know, starting, you know, I mean, it's lower to being a wetland. It's closer to being a wetland than it is to be an upland, where it is right now. So there's less work or less digging to do, but clearly it's not very
it's
valuable.
Not
piece
it's not
of,
functioning
at
the
time.
No, it's functioning. Yeah, it's
just what
you
I'm,
had an issue with something there.
Becky, does that Pachysandra grow in wet?
No, it's more of a nice upland ground cover.
And that's mostly Pachysandra was in that area.
I don't remember what it was.
Chuck, do you think that this leaf filled area is an upland?
No, the Pachysandra was
yeah,
as we were walking
marginal.
In. I remember that. There was a ton of
it. Oh, it was also right when we were standing at those people's driveway. It was all
okay.
In front
so
of them.
Was it on the slope or was it down in the leaf litter?
It was
you know,
past
we'd have
the leaf
do,
litter.
We'd have to do a
okay.
Little bit
more towards
the
back.
We need
the
wider than the first
wall.
Yeah,
but right now,
should we do
so
it?
I know they're already
another
proposing
site visit just to, look in
to
that area?
Remove the leaf litter as
right.
Part of their mitigation. But they're not proposing to turn it into a wetland. So that would mean getting the soils at the correct level and doing some planting over there.
Yeah.
So those are the two steps they could add to what they've already. To have a little bit better situation here and something more palatable commission to think about.
I think that's more palatable. I think this is adding more value than certainly a finger.
It would be more than triple
yeah,
as it's shown
more,
here.
It's
but that,
square
that,
footage,
that's about 1,200 square feet.
Wouldn't we be just asking for 2-to-1 replacement of that?
Right.
Of the
area.
Yeah,
of
the square thing. Footage
so
of the
let's
figure.
Let's separate this out because we would like to see the whole leaf area removed from a wetland replication, from as Chuck was saying, that the next step of plantings, the correct soils, what the right thing to actually make this into a nice, healthy wetland is the 2-to-1 area. Not necessarily the. We don't hold somebody to a higher standard.
Right. So we're looking at square footage of 2-to-1.
They might volunteer to do it.
You know, you're going to remove the leaf litter.
Yes.
It might not be. You might not be putting a wetland replication in the whole area. It would be that
part wetland, part upland.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So depending on what you do the measurements of the plan. I mean, that's something to consider.
No, because that's setting a precedent.
No.
Anika, are you okay with this?
Yeah, I just want to mention also, I'm also a fan of tiny houses, but, you know, I know it may not
My
be.
My wife is too.
You're not living in a tiny house.
Okay. I would be happy living in a brand new constructed tiny house. I will go on
okay.
record.
I'm a resident of one.
Really?
You know how many tiny houses I could put on? Really? Move my kids their own house. They'd love it.
So I think those are some thoughts. Could I just address...
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Let's before we move on to another aspect.
Yeah, I just wanted to walk through that scenario just a bit more. So replacing this area 2-1 over here, this then would be, let's say not filled, but that could be then used as possible yard area or...
I would be completely against filling it. I would, at that point, recognize...
Well, we're now doing a replication.
You could absolutely, you'd be meeting, if you meet the requirements for removing a portion of the wetland but I think you would have to show that this area is completely outside of the current wetland area.
Leave the finger. It's still protected by the buffer zone, you know what I mean?
I think that's a measure for us to accept what we're seeing, at least for me, that's a measure to accept what we're seeing inside the area and the reduced buffer.
Can I take a stab at that?
Yeah.
So in some situations in Reading, that 25 foot is the zone of natural vegetation. Now, if the commission comes across an area that has been cleared, unlike what's here now, you can recreate natural vegetation in that area. So it would be more like a landscape looking natural vegetation, something that works. It wouldn't be all trees. It would be levels of trees, maybe shrubs, bushes, and then trees in the back. So it looks like you have a larger lawn. But lawn is not natural vegetation, so that's out. So it would be...
It'll be left as is.
Yeah. So between the 25 and the 35, that 10 foot, that can be lawn.
Okay, that 10 foot between 35.
Gotcha. But when it's 2R, you'd still be in the 25 foot zone of natural vegetation from that flag anyway.
So there's still a variance required, is that what you said?
Yes.
No, the structure wouldn't. I'm saying you couldn't really turn that into lawn because you'd still be in the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation.
Give the variance, recognize it, but in recognition of the fact that they're doing the replication, I don't think you want to...
You're going to probably...
get a variance and a new set of plans.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
I didn't know where you were going with that.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what I'm getting at. I guess move on to a different topic. The rain barrels are something that can be moved. You know, somebody moves in, they get rid of them, and now they're not storage capacity any longer. Has anybody ever seen that? I don't think I've ever seen that done as, like, that's the artificial storage capacity.
That's the last possible
solution,
yeah, when there's nothing else to do. I also was going to ask, if you didn't, you probably don't have the separation to do some sort of infiltration.
Underground tank.
Could you do
that's what I was looking at,
some sort of roof leaders into, you know, like a swale that's kind of a vegetated rain garden type situation, but get a pipe
I was that wanted to do an in-ground tank, like a 1,000-gallon tank in the ground, but we don't have the water separation for the overflow to go out into a infiltration chamber or leach chamber. It wasn't feasible here with the groundwater being at that height.
No, I think that's a great idea. I mean, that's to me, the drums are something. 10 years from now, somebody's gonna forget that they were actually required to be there, and we just move them out of the way. And now all of a sudden, we're infiltrating more water than was supposed to be there. It's a more of a permanent solution when you find something else.
Does this have a basement or just a frost wall?
Slab. Just slab on grid. right, so it's no basement.
Just wanted to make sure everyone knew that.
Yeah.
We received a, are there any more questions from the commission? We received a letter from Mrs. Melanson. Is she here? Okay. Did you have any comments?
I did see those comments, and I started to draft a letter to address those. I will read it verbatim, but basically, what...
You want to read the comments so that the rest of the people here know them?
Okay, number one, additions to intent. Prior notices and meetings have addressed only the intent to build a single-family dwelling in a driveway. There is now mention of an attached garage and appurtenances. Will this increase the loss of vegetation and soil?
So I'm not sure if Ms. Melanson was considered the ANRAD as part of this planning when she states that in the previous notice. I'm not sure what she means by previous notice. This is the first notice. This is the
first notice that's before this commission. The only other time you guys have been before us is with the ANRAD where we were just determining the wetland line.
Correct.
But
yeah.
The answer to that is no because it's a garage under a bed.
That too.
I like that answer better.
Prior meeting and in a private conversation with you, Chuck, I expressed concern that removing soil for the foundation would lessen the lot's ability to hold some of the water. I also expressed concern that removing vegetation would also deplete the property's ability to absorb some of the water. And
yeah.
I was told that there were many ways to minimize the impact, such as not allowing a full basement, which you're not, and installing a slow filtration system.
Mm-hmm.
I believe this should be addressed.
Yeah, and if I can just jump in, they're all addressed right now. We added rain garden, and that's a slow infiltration system. We've increased the storage by addition of the mitigation area, which would be more wetland. I forgot the last one, but I know we did it too. What was that?
Foundation.
And the foundation already is great, slab on grade.
Yep. And then there's an issue on the culvert. Never known the town to maintain the current stream or culvert. Neighbors have attempted to keep the stream and culvert clear of both trash and debris from the street and fallen trees and leaves. And I believe you have mentioned that you will be looking at the culvert to,
mm-hmm.
to...
So in the past, on Van Norton Road, we have a gentleman that has a culvert in his property. You might know him pretty well. And part of his order of conditions is that he needs to keep that culvert clean. It's his responsibility. I don't know if we can force someone to do that, but that's gonna be written into this order of condition to have somewhat of a maintenance plan, whatever the commission accepts, on the stream channel so it doesn't block up and back up, and to keep the entrance to that culvert clean. And at least check it twice a year or some mention. We might look at Van Norton
Raven's in the
I also wrote something to that. The existing culvert under Havel Street is on town property. It is the responsibility of the town to maintain. That said, the applicant may take initiative from time to time to clear the culvert if debris is an obstruction or to cause a nuisance onto the property, but I don't think that can be made a stipulation to
enforceable.
I would agree.
We'll ask, and we'll
okay.
we'll ask. I know what you're saying, but the reality is the town can't get to every culvert, and if someone was going to take an interest, it is
mainly I've seen that
it's going to flood.
I know.
So
sure,
it's to your interest.
It's
for the culvert.
Certainly to their interest.
I mean, and it's
but
not this raging
I don't know that
stream.
We want, I don't know that we can make it their responsibility.
And I don't know that I would want to go into the stream and do anything in there because I don't want to be accused
right.
of doing something to the wetland that
right.
I shouldn't be doing.
Well, and part of the, if anything's written into the order, we could write something sort of like, we encourage the property owner to be diligent, just checking it and being in contact with town officials about what's appropriate clean
right.
out.
The stream is yours.
How to take care of that. Because he's gonna need some directions and limits of what's, how far to go with that, what's allowable and what's not.
Yeah, we're not talking about raking it out. If there's a branch or two in it, you're gonna get those out. And if you go there enough, it's gonna be something that just happened. It's not gonna be a year later when it's embedded itself into the bags and you're gonna cause damage. So
we definitely, you know, even though we like, you know, we like the wetlands, we also know it's critically important to keep these culverts clear and open.
Yeah.
And it kind of takes everybody's eyes and everybody's effort. And there are plenty of people with the best of intentions who have gone in and have done some harm, you know. And I don't want you to get stuck in that situation. So, you know, please feel free to be in touch about that.
And then we also discussed ways to prevent rainwater and oil from flowing down the driveway into the wetlands, lessening further flooding of the area. You suggested to use rain barrels, but we've talked about doing something else. So I think we've addressed that issue.
For the driveway, we also have that edge trench too.
Okay. And then the lastly, residents. It is my understanding that as the intended owner, resident of the property, Mr. Gillis, is eligible for variances, not afforded a developer. Are there any stipulations attached to duration of residence? The builder has a history of buying building and quick turnover in sales, and that's something.
Is that, that's outside of the
That's
duration.
Not, we have
that's
nothing,
zoning.
We cannot put any kind of a stipulation into an order of conditions regarding that issue.
We do plan on living there, so.
I know that. I just I don't know how to respond to that.
It's outside of the
question. Right. So we've heard from the commission members and Mrs. Melanson, who represents part of the community. Are there any issues or questions, comments from any other members in the audience?
I'm Rosemary Murphy. I live at 47 Matchelder Road, so I bought the corner of that property there. And when I bought my home 14 years ago, I was told it was conservation land, and nothing was ever going to be built on that land. So I'm surprised I didn't get the first letter about this intent. So I'm just hearing about it now. So I have a lot of concerns about it. We get water in our yard anyway, which is part of it. That stream just sort of runs down into my yard. I don't have a problem with that because it's nature. I have a problem that now there's going to be a house there. I'm going to get a displacement of water. There's a pump station there because there is a lot of water, so I have a concern about that. I have a concern about 25 trees being cut down, and there's going to be a one-to-one, but I don't think blueberry bushes are trees, so are there going to be 25 new trees put in there or not? So I heard blueberry bushes, I didn't hear trees. There used to be a 100-foot buffer zone. I couldn't cut down a tree in my yard because of that area, but now there's a house going there? I don't understand. I don't get that. And now, so we've gone from 100-foot to a 35-foot, and now we're not even gonna honor the 35-foot. Am I understanding that correctly? I'm kind of aghast about the whole thing. I wanna know, how many invasive species are there? And I think the area, I've seen it over the years, and it looks healthy. I know Barbara likes to drop her clippings over the side, this is a goodwill thing to clean up the area and put healthy plants in there. I think it's healthy as it is. Who's going to monitor this? And when the next person comes, when you sell it in a year, and the next person comes in, and no one tells the next person that you can't do this, this, and this, and they just go ahead and do it, what recourse do you have for that?
A lot of ways to answer those. Anybody want to take a stab?
So the last one, part of this notice of intent would be the requirements of what's being
requirement in the order of conditions that the new homeowner receives a copy of the deed and sends us verification that they have received that copy. So
any O&M that's associated with this property moving forward is going to be attached with any change of hands as it goes forward.
And then they would be responsible. So neighbors called up and said, I want to get into the stream issue again, but let's say the streams, they're getting backup. I could call John and ask him if he has looked at the stream, if there's any backup there. It's a culvert issue, maybe DPW.
How much monitoring that do you truly do? Do you call people up?
How much?
Yeah.
I react when people call me. I can't look at every place in Reading, and I don't know what's going on. But a lot of times, neighbors know that when they make phone calls, that this town does react to them. They're pretty responsive. So that's your neighborhood. That's your basement getting flooded. If something's going on, you can make a call. DPW, Conservation Office, Planning, whatever wherever. It'll get to the right person.
There's a violation to the order of conditions or a further violation of the wetlands bylaw, the commission can fine up to $300 a day until remediation is done for that. That also helps to protect with vigilant neighbors.
I also like to address some of your comments. There are invasives in this wetland, so it's not pristine.
I know
wetland.
It's not pristine, and I know Barbara's put a few of them in herself. So
right, and I'd like to address the clippings.
Mm-hmm.
That's a violation of the Wetlands Protection Act and the Reading bylaw. That's filling, actual filling, and
she's been doing that for years and years.
Well, this is why we've got this large leaf pile, and that the applicant is removing that. And when we have new applications and we see those piles of leaves and debris, tree debris, we ask that those be removed before we issue an order of conditions, a permit. That's part of, and there's an awful lot of dumping in Reading. I hate to say that. What else was I going to address?
Trees.
Oh, the trees. You know, the 100-foot buffer zone, there are, you can do work within the 100-foot buffer zone. I'd like to make sure you understand we have a 25-foot natural vegetation zone. And then you have within 35 feet, there's no structure. But beyond the 35 out to 100, there are a lot of applications, obviously, in town that there is building going on. I'd like to address the trees. Because in the past, people have come in and asked for to remove trees, and there has not been a real consistent way of dealing with that. You know, we have some trees that are right up next to houses that represent danger if there's a strong wind, especially with those white pines and like a shallow root system, so that we have a replacement. And then in the replacement, it's, you can replace with a tree or several bushes. So that's how we do that.
One-to-one is misleading. If you replace with a bush, it's not a one-to-one replacement.
It's more
than
one.
Bushes.
And the bushes do provide habitat and food for, wildlife. So they're not without their significance. I can't think of anything else.
The rain. The additional... water associated with
displacement.
So there would be there's measures to assist the infiltration, including this rain garden that we were talking about, trench drains. And one of the things I'd like to just make sure we get with that, and I don't know if it was included here or not, I was looking through, is just the calculations saying for certain storms that they have the capacity to handle stormwater drops.
Okay. Are there any other comments or questions? Yep.
Yeah, I'm Phyllis Maxwell, and I live 93 Bachelors. So I'm feeling that the house is practically in my backyard, and the driveway will be, I think, 3 feet from my driveway. I have concerns about water, but I even have more concerns about the trees coming down. It has been natural habitat for so understand trees need to come down to build the house, but I really have concerns. I mean, I've been there almost 50 years, and I was told from the time I bought the house until I came to this hearing that that was unbuildable. Too low, too wet, too small. So I know things have changed, but the land hasn't changed. So I really do have some concerns.
Do we have, yeah?
Oh, I was just wondering if the applicant has talked to the town about the setbacks and...
Yeah, I have spoken with Julie Mercer for the town. Glenn was out of, was in the office at the time.
So did you get an answer to these setbacks?
These setbacks, as some lawyers have done some work for the property, they determined that the town cannot enforce any setbacks because the lot was pre-existing before zoning was enforced, came about the zoning requirement setbacks in 1953. So when I approached Julie, I said, obviously I don't want to put it at the property line. I want to try and give as much setbacks as possible. And she said to give us your worst case, the best that I could do, which would be their worst case scenario, and we'd go from there. And she said the town council is aware of this, and they said they would make a determination once it has reached that state, you know, in the process, if it got through this process here. She said the town council might say, you are correct, there is nothing we can do with setback requirements. So I'm trying to meet as much as I can on the setbacks with this lot.
Can you move that now that we just talked about this 35 foot being reduced and all that?
It's tough to move it from the side property line because...
No, to Haverhill Street.
I wouldn't be able to get the driveway.
Well, leave the driveway there, bring the house forward and, I don't know, put an angle, not an angle, but...
Curve it.
Yeah.
That would further reduce the setback as well because of the curve and the roads.
Is it going to come forward and go down towards the wetland?
Well, no, it would have to come forward. Yeah, exactly, right. It would have to come down forward and closer to the wetland.
Closer to the wetland.
We're just at 18 feet right now.
Right now.
And from the bachelor side, as it sets the radius.
Because you have some leeway with the amount of leaf litter out there and the amount of that wetland that you're going to replace. And if you're going to, you might be able to take just a little bit more off that off area. And I'm not suggesting, you guys are supposed to come in with a plan, but you need to look at all these things that we're suggesting and then come up with something, and we're supposed to respond to it. But you can see where some of these things are going. Maybe to get that off the property line is ultimately more important than to recreate just a little bit more wetland. It looks like you have a spot.
If you look at the stakes, I mean, they're literally right on top of her driveway. If you look at where the stakes are.
Yeah, we just talked about that.
It's crazy.
Yeah,
so we saw that today. It's excessive.
So.
Driveways can go on the property wherever. There's no setbacks for a driveway to a property line. Many people have driveways that touch each other.
And where's the house going? Right onto her driveway, right?
No, it's a driveway.
Okay, we need to move on. Do I hear a motion to continue?
So we live at 709 Haverhill Street, right across from the property, and I agree with both Rosemary and and we've been there now for 15 years, and it's fun to watch the water rise. It's fun to watch the different salamanders and stuff. The kids, you know, go over there and peek at the vegetation, and it's a beautiful area that I'm just disappointed that it's even put out there to be taken away.
My question regarding trees being taken down, what and how many are being taken down? What is being replaced? Do we have any specific trees?
Yes, we do.
On the Haverhill Street side, et cetera.
Yes, we have on the map that was provided in the application, they've identified all the trees on the site above a certain
6 inches,
and they have identified which trees would be taken down and how they would be replacing them. There's a whole row of trees along the Haverhill Batchelder side of the proposed house, and there are shrubs, and they're also removing invasive plant materials in the wetlands. And now we've got some talk of a wetland replication area of a 2-to-1.
My question on that replication, so you're going to, are you diverting this stream?
No.
Are you, you're not moving the stream? Okay.
No, they're adding in an area adjacent to the wetland area, adding to it. Can you identify yourself, please?
Yeah, I'm Will Finch, 51 Mill Street. I was a previous member of the Conservation Commission and was on the commission when a previous proposal was made. It didn't get too far because the applicant realized that it wasn't feasible. The issue with replicating wetlands is that they're almost impossible to be done successfully. And in my experience, the only time it's been done and required is when there's been a road crossing that had to go through a wetland in order to develop upland that was in behind. CONSCOM has always required removal of leaves and other things that have been dumped by by the owner or by neighbors. So I don't see that as extra mitigation, really, in this case. I've seen houses that are only 14 feet wide. There's one up in Gloucester. It's a prefab house. They go in really quickly. So there's certainly ways to redesign the house to stay out of the buffer zone. I collect all the rain off my roof. And I know that rain barrels are a lot of maintenance. You have to check them during and after every rainfall. And with my calculations, you need a half gallon of storage per square foot of roof to collect the first 1 inch rainfall event.
But Will, then they're adding something else for the runoff. So
right,
it's not just the rain barrels.
Right, but once you've got the groundwater that high, you're not gonna get a lot of infiltration. I'm just saying what you get with rain barrels.
All right, do I have a motion to continue?
I make a motion to continue as long as the applicant is willing to.
Are you willing to look at the plan and address some of the issues that have brought forward? Okay. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comments.
When we get a new plan, I think we should schedule another site visit, particularly the area on the.
Yeah. Would that be okay, Mr. Gillis?
I think it will. I don't know. Yeah.
We can always do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
We should be able to do that.
All right.
I don't think we're sure.
Even if it's just us. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just I want to get out and see what.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is 7:10. Apologize. Notice of intent, 88 Glenmere Circle, map 15, lot 84. Is Mr. and Mrs. Zhu, if I got that correctly?
Yes,
it's a notice of intent. And can you identify yourself, please?
Yes, I'm Frederick Geisel, G-E-I-S-E-L. I'm a professional civil engineer working with civil environmental consultants from Peabody. This project is for an addition, plus a deck and stairs to access the rear on the property. The commission was out yesterday and basically came up with a revised wetland line, and we have modified the plans today to incorporate that, and I have some copies. There's two full-size copies and some reduced copies. which the only thing changed on the plan is the wetlands line and then the buffer zone from that. The addition is an 18 by 24 foot addition. Right now there's an existing deck on the back. It's over that portion plus the additional area. The deck will be replaced on the end behind the existing house, and there'll be some stairs coming from the ground up to a landing access to the deck. It's a single story addition. This house was built in 1948. Has a very small kitchen, no dining room, and this is to provide a family room, expand the kitchen, and provide an eat-in area, dining area, family room to basically fit today's needs. The revised plans that you've been given show that the 50-foot buffer basically on this line here, I'm sorry, this is the 35-foot buffer is here. If I can put this plan up here.
Can we shut this off?
What's that? You shut that? Okay.
Yeah.
So that right now we have, this is the wetlands line, 25-foot buffer, and the 35-foot buffer is where our straw wattle siltation barrier will be, and the our infiltrators are inside that line, 35-foot line, and no part of the structure is inside the 50, outside, sorry, within the 50-foot buffer. So, I mean, obviously there'll be excavation for the infiltrators, but the permanent part of the structure will be at least 50 feet away from the wetlands. These are revised wetland lines. So that's basically what's changed from the original plan that was given you. We're infiltrating the roof runoff from the proposed addition with two infiltrators. I just found out that there was an existing dry well that takes runoff from the end of the garage. We're not sure where it goes, and we could, if that's disturbed at all with this construction, then we would propose to add an additional infiltrator on and then connect that roof leader into that so that would be replicated, essentially. There are no trees to be removed. There's a little bit of shrubbery and, you know, vegetation around the house that will be removed. I'm sure we'll have some plantings come back, but there's no wetlands vegetation removed. We're not anywhere near the wetlands, and there's no trees to be removed for this project.
Can you go over the site visit notes? I don't have notes. These are the measurements that we took.
Okay.
So we had a site visit?
Yes, we had a site visit, and we looked at the vegetation and saw skunk cabbage, jewel weed. Much further towards the house than originally where the flags were. So we took tape measure and measured off where we thought that the line would be based on vegetation and topography. And there was, you know, there was a stone wall out there pretty close to where hydric vegetation stopped and the upland vegetation started. So
Chuck gave me all.
Supposed to this new line match where we
Yes, it does appear to be. Did you take a look at this, Chuck?
I did.
Yeah.
I did. It looks like the changes. I emailed the changes. And
Chuck has sent me the, and we basically moved the lines from where we had marked them
yeah.
toward the house. The distances that Chuck had given me for all the flags.
We didn't move them. We did
you
the
taped over
off of the flag towards the house.
We moved everyone.
Yes.
I have a question about the project. Is it, are any native vegetation or trees or anything going to be disturbed or cut or removed as part of this? So any grading, any
filling? It comes up with the hill that comes up to here, and that'll basically remain pretty much the same.
And there's this kind of like walkway out.
Walkway out.
Yeah,
that's
it's
gonna be underneath.
Interesting.
That's gonna be underneath the deck, so there'll be an access.
Oh, that's gonna stay?
That'll basically stay there. One side of it with this rocks on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
So this side here, which is on the foundation, that'll be replaced with the solid foundation so that they'll have a little bit wider area there. But basically that'll pretty much stay as is. So we wouldn't have to disturb everything on the other side. There may be some disturbance for putting in the support posts for the deck.
Well, you'll have to do some disturbance to install the infiltrator.
Yes, that's it. That's basically in the grass area.
Okay.
In the backyard. There's no trees
grass.
Or
gotcha.
no trees, shrubs, or anything in there except for grass. So.
And you have enough separation from groundwater to put
it
in existing grade?
I do think so because there's no water in the basement coming from the ground, and this would be down above the basement level.
The wetland is basically follows one. It looks like a perennial stream out there, but then there's another swale that came in.
Swale that comes
so,
out
from yeah.
here.
4 or 5 feet above that?
Hmm?
Like this is 4 or 5 feet above that?
Okay, at least.
Yeah. It's interesting to me that the wetlands line on this particular project is almost perpendicular to the topography lines. That's a little odd to me, but I understand if you're on a steep slope.
It's about
you know,
10 feet gradient difference.
Yeah, I mean, if you look
yeah.
at it, Anika, you can see the 110 is like an area where things end, and it gets down to 104 on the other side. So,
so the house in the grassed area is quite a ways up from that.
Up from that, right.
The stream.
It's over 50 feet from the wetlands line, and close to 80 feet from where the stream is down here. Again, the stream that runs through here, and then there is a swale that comes down through here, and there's another one on the other side over here, lead down to the stream.
Which design storm or what sort of measure did you use to size the infiltrator?
We looked at 2 10, 25-year storms.
Okay. Can you just get me the just the inch? I'm just curious to know the actual rainfall.
It's like 5.6 inches of rainfall.
For the two?
No, that 3.2, 4.5.
Oh, okay, thanks.
5, and then, yeah, there's 5.6.
So the max was 5.6 for the
25-year storm.
The 25.
Well, you could size something for a 100-year storm. The situation is that the gutters aren't going to collect all the water. So you basically would size it for about the 25-year storm maximum, because most of anything more than that, the water is going to sheet over the gutters and not get into the system anyway. So.
No.
But
it'll be like pouring buckets on the roof; it'll just splash off.
Right. You can't collect at all.
Yeah.
But this will take both of the storms. I was in Boston last week for hearing. We have an underground garage, which is just barely below the 100-year flood zone, but it's basically a garage. There's no living space, anything there. But we have a trench drain here to collect anything which might come off of cars which are parked in the garage. And one of the commission members said, "Well, what's going to happen during a 100-year storm? The water will be over that. You'll be getting water into the sewer because it's connected to the storm sewer." So we do actually have a absorbent pad that goes in there, but do we design something to work for the one day in 100 years and the other 35,000 days is not in our way. So this is the thing, you know.
But it seems that, you know, rain events like we had in the last couple days, you know, if you look at the history of rainfall, and there's data sources for this. There's like Cornell and
right.
You know, you could get something realistic for Reading and realistic, you know, as of, you know, using valid verified data.
Right.
You could get
that,
some solid numbers
yes.
up to
yes.
like last month or even
right.
last year, you know. And I guess I'm just wondering, is that what these rainfall amounts that you're talking about are? Or are they from like 19?
Yes.
Pre-
yes.
Oh, okay.
We use that, yes. We
you did use
we
the
Cornell
numbers.
Yes.
Okay.
It's
good.
Not a requirement of DEP because it's you know, a single family house is,
well,
you don't have to worry about. But no, we use those numbers.
You know, and nobody's going to say, nobody can predict for certainty what's going to happen tomorrow and the next month and the next month. This is all about trends and all about
right.
stuff like that. But thanks.
Chuck, do you have any questions?
I just wanted to mention the yard waste that's in the back. There's some in the left-hand side and some on the right-hand side of the back, the backyard. And we would ask that that's removed as part of this project.
But that condition, yes. Sorry.
Yes.
We discussed that earlier. Certainly, we obviously have the opportunity when we're doing some demo and the
sure.
building there to,
mm.
to remove that stuff
that's
at
great.
That time
yep.
very easily.
Are there any questions from the audience?
Chuck, do you have anything ready for this?
No.
Because it was
still. I don't know, I'm going to click that he does.
I move we continue this notice of intent. I don't have any additional questions.
Why do you want to continue it?
I like the practice of Chuck prepares
oh,
it.
Oh,
there could be a second.
And approve it next meeting. There's,
right, okay.
There's nothing necessarily additional that we're looking for, but there's a timing issue. As long as the applicant has no issues with that, we'll Chuck
we
would
close at the clock.
Basically. Chuck would basically start preparing the
order
of conditions so that it's ready for us to review for the next meeting. We can sit down, read it, make sure everything's in there, and close and approve it at that point. So as long as the applicant doesn't have any continue the next meeting.
Do you have a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Chuck, would you send me a draft of something?
Yeah, probably.
Okay. Week or so.
Yeah.
You know, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is a notice of intent. Tennessee Gas Pipeline off Beaver Road, map near 46, lot near 158. It's a public hearing. Is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the General Reading Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant presents proposal, commission received report. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions. I'd like to introduce members of the commission, starting on my right.
Okay.
David Pinnett.
Anika Scanlon.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Al Couillard. Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator.
I'm Diana Walden from BSC Group. I'm an environmental scientist, and we're working with Tennessee Gas Pipeline on this issue. It's basically there's a 12-inch diameter natural gas pipeline underground that runs through Reading. It's called the Beverly Salem Lateral. And regular inspections of the pipeline have identified the fact that what was once underground has now been exposed by a street. So the pipe crosses under this unnamed perennial tributary to Bear Meadow Brook. And basically, I think over time, with increased precipitation, possibly runoff from it's a very dense residential development all around the area. Over time, the stream has probably become incised. Eroded. It's the entire, you know, the elevation profile of the stream has lowered to the point where the pipeline is basically kind of sitting on the stream bed at this point. It's going to be underground. And so in needing to maintain the pipe protected, we've come up with this proposed solution lay these over the contour of the land, trench them in upstream and downstream and up gradient and down gradient, and basically kind of create a surface on the bank over the bed of the channel and back up the other bank. And with the correct trenching and a rock subgrade down gradient of the flow and of the mats, basically providing a protective surface over the pipe. And in this case, it will elevate the stream bed in this location, but it won't, so we have alterations, but we're not losing stream and we're not losing wetlands. The portion of the mat will be within a BVW that's located on one of the banks of the stream. What you can do though is put it under the vegetation, under the soil, and try to get vegetation kind of grow back over it on the surface. And then the rest of the impact shown, basically this hatched area is a configuration of six of these submar mats, up to six, basically what's needed in the field. And then that's about a 25 foot wide by 30 foot long configuration of the submar mats. The area around it is the trenching to get them into the ground and then backfilled. This is the subgrade, downgrading of the flow. And this other hatched area is actually erosion control blankets to stabilize the banks. And Chuck, maybe the photos might be a good thing to show?
Yes.
Just to kind of show you what the situation is out there. I know several members were out on a site visit earlier this week, but this is the right-of-way crosses near the intersection of Lucy Drive and Beaver Road, and this is a view from a private driveway off of Beaver Road. There's a bridge crossing over the stream, and this is the pipeline sitting on the stream bed. It's in a casing at that point, but it's basically exposed to the air. And then if you want to scroll down just a little bit further, just some closer views of the pipeline with the flow. These photos were taken pretty soon after some heavy, at least an inch and a half rain that we had earlier in June. And on the eastern bank, heading up to Eastway, the neighborhood off of Eastway, it's a fairly steep bank, so there's no associated wetland on that bank. But on the side adjacent to Beaver Road, the slope is a little more slight, and so there is a low-lying reporting vegetated wetland adjacent to the stream in this case. And basically, this is an existing utility. This maintenance and repair is required to protect the pipe, just based on its location in the stream. To the wetlands, there's not really an alternative to direct impacts, and working even in the Reading 25 foot buffer that we've talked about, the stream itself, the wetland itself, and so we do have to ask for a variance to work in the resource areas, and we're also asking for a variance to the local Reading bylaw fees, just calculating up. I believe it's $11 for every linear foot of bank impacted, temporary or permanent, $11 for every square foot of wetlands and stream bed. I believe in the 25 foot buffer, there's additional $1.25 per square foot. And so with all of that, we're actually at filing fees beyond the Wetland Protection Act filing fees of $17,585. So we were in discussing that with Chuck. He recommended that we address that with you, ask you if there was a filing fee that's more appropriate for the work that has to be done too.
Are you proposing a separate value or is that part of just a discussion?
I was gonna ask the commission to think about that or ask that.
Is this the original intent of this pipe was to be buried? Is this a function of scour?
Yes.
Yeah,
that mm-hmm. It was buried.
It was buried. Yeah,
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 correct.
Yeah. So
how long is it? This you need to tell them how long the pipe has been there.
is the late 1950s this pipe was put in.
Okay.
So, you know, over time, you know, the ground is very silty out there. So just over time, it just slowly eroded away is what we think happened.
Making a new location.
Yeah.
And the manager, I'm sorry.
Just the matting would go, would be at the same elevation as the pipe. I know you had a cross section up there. Can you look
quickly? Chuck, can we scroll to the cross section there?
One page.
One or two down.
Yeah. The details.
Up, back up one.
Up one?
There.
So the matting goes over it.
And you actually have to tell up to the top of the pipe some material before the mat can go over it too. So
from the top, no, sorry.
Oh, no, go ahead.
Okay, so from the top of the pipe, you're going to be adding about another 10 inches.
Okay.
To account for the little bit of fill that's going to go, for the little bit of fill that's going to go in here, and then we're going to have the articulated concrete mats on top. Well, it'll be about 10 inches.
There's going to be some sort of like damming action that occurs associated with that, correct? I mean, the
pipe itself is causing a little bit of a dam as well, and the water is finding
new ways around.
Yes. It's etching away at the bank there. I believe that the stream has, I mean, the pipe has that casing, which makes it a little bit higher in that location, and then there's a portion where I don't believe it is in the casing any longer, and the water's kind of finding its way around that lower spot.
Correct. There's a concrete casing around the pipe, and it protects it for streams and stuff like in situations like this.
Okay.
So by the time we identify the pipe, it's not, we're not looking at bare steel. It's already protected. But what's already happening is around the outside edge, it's taken the path of least resistance, so it's cut into the bank a little bit so that the water currently is flowing over some bare steel.
And I think that is in one of the photos too, if you did want to go back and see that if you're interested. But during the site visit, they did talk about trying to lay the mats in a way that we do find some sort of low flow channel. And there is that low lying wetland that will most likely accept some of the kind of the high flow. And you know, just in the grading, try to make a way for the water to find its way around the pipe in a better location.
I have a question, just out of curiosity. Do you by chance happen to know how far below the surface that pipe was originally back in the 50s? Like, is there a standard of depth?
If it was built in the 50s, they probably had standard would have been 3 feet of cover. Granted, we're going back to 50s. I obviously wasn't around then. I can't verify it. But typically, the goal is to have 3 feet.
They had 3 feet back then.
Yeah. you know, today, if it was built, it'd be 5 feet below a stream.
It's interesting.
50s was probably 3 feet.
So as a follow-up to that, does your proposed construction in these plans, does that cover the suitable amount of protection for that pipe with these proposed plans, or is it cutting it close, or is it?
No,
are we safely there?
The reason these articulated concrete mats were chosen is because they will offer the level of protection that are necessary to hold this in place long term. And with that, because they're sturdy, we only have to go about 10 inches above. If there was other methods, then you'd be talking a much greater depth. But with these mats, they hold very well. Yes.
I guess my biggest question is not necessarily right now about how the pipe's going to get covered. It's what's going to happen to the stream water after that. What's that going to look like?
During construction? Like the actual construction?
The permanent condition.
Once it's in place, what does that stream flow? I mean, are we talking it is an effective dam? Are we talking that it's going to have a constant, you know, what's going to be the base flow around that pipe?
Well, what would happen is because we're putting as of right now, the pipe is already acting as a dam. So what will happen is it will continue to act as a dam in a way, but what will happen is the water will continue to flow over. So there will be some ponding upstream, but the water will continue to flow.
So the
pipe is open underneath.
It's scoured under.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I yeah, that's kind of a challenge technically, because that pipe is literally perpendicular to the stream. There's no changing the pipe at all. I don't know, technically speaking, what sort of design considerations could help this stream continue to function the way it clearly wants to. I mean, it's got a sediment demand because of its velocity, and that's what scoured out that. So if you put that in, just sort of thinking out loud if I can, if my brain works correctly. So if you put that in and you get back up, let's say it acts as a dam until a certain volume storm, and then you'll get the overflow. Would you get additional downstream scour? Maybe.
That's why you got the riprap on the
downstream side.
Can we do anything more natural than that? Or riprap's not stream bed. I mean, I'm talking base on the stream bed. You're talking the bank, there's riprap?
No, this is downstream.
Riprap.
This is riprap.
Okay.
Riprap may be a bad term for it, because it's more, probably smaller than that. What do you have at the bottom of these?
We can do I would assume
like,
some sort of rounded stone.
Stone apron would be another term, if that's what you're referring to.
Okay.
This is downstream.
How many feet downstream? I'm sorry, I'm having trouble with the scale. So
it's a 10-foot.
Okay. Yeah.
The site visit, they said 15 feet on either side of the pipe and 12 feet from the center of the stream up the bank. So 25 feet side to side, 30 feet long in total.
That's the max.
Yeah.
But then there's the apron app.
That is a.
No, I think that included the apron. So they said that was the limits of where he was looking.
So what's the length of the pipe that's encased in concrete?
I would say it's probably about 12 feet, 12 to 15.
Yeah.
So when you make this, when you do what you're going to do, you brim it up and the level's low, all the period of time the level's low, the water's going to go around this because it's like a dam. How long is it going to be before it's to bare metal?
You're continuing
on either side. It's
going to
go
that.
Either side, and it's going to erode the same way, and it's going to, we're going to be in the same boat probably less than 5 years from now.
Well,
not with
the
articulated
concrete mats. Not with these concrete mats. I think what you're going to see, if this is all adequately tied in to the channel banks, and the channel banks are high enough, and I think I have to look at this a little bit more carefully.
You'll get
sediment deposition upstream before
the
pipe. That will start to fill in with all the sediment load that usually would blow through. So you'll get sediment, so it'll start to backfill behind this thing, upstream of it.
Right.
And then you'll get additional scour out downstream.
Yeah,
and
start going over more.
Right,
more
if it's
around.
Up higher, yeah.
Yeah.
The interesting thing was that during the time I was out there, flow was fairly high, and I've kind of measured the deepest portion of the channel, so it would be like the low flow channel, the Thalwick. And on average, it was about a foot. But right before and right after the pipe, it was about a foot and a half. So bringing it up, you know, it already is fairly well scoured before and after. So maybe there is some room in the volume and in the water to be bringing that up. And, you know, to the point that we can, you know, the problem is we're restrained to a right-of-way. You know, if this was free and clear to do anything, you know, I mean, you could do something with the grade of the stream and make it eventually meet some point, you know, upstream that is at the right elevation. But yeah, you know, we are restrained to this right-of-way for the most part. But, you know, to some degree, in the installation, they can maybe try to like back up a little bit too.
So let me ask just a slightly different question. The fill material that's going to go in around the pipe before the concrete mat gets put on top, is that going to be if the nature of that material allows for the water to flow through it.
There's a geomembrane around it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it can't flow through.
If it acts like a semi-porous dam, do you know what I'm saying?
I understand.
But it can't. There's a geomembrane around.
Well, it's gonna get silted up no matter what.
Yeah. No.
If you
look at the cross section, you've got your concrete mass. There's a geomembrane
right here
below, and then you've got your fill. That's getting trenched in. It's acting like an impermeable barrier.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to go through. What I'm saying is, it's not going to go through.
Oh, that's like HDP.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I ask another question?
But it's
going to
come from below.
Because
the hydraulic head.
I mean,
I'm sure this isn't the first time you've ever used this system. Can you give us some historical perspective of other areas and other sites that you've used this in the past?
It takes time to actually flow underneath.
So there's two recent ones that we just did. One was in Tieringham, Massachusetts, and another was in Southwick, Massachusetts. Tieringham was it was a little bit more rocky than this site, and it worked out well. We've been back there since. It's been a couple of years now, and everything's protected. Everything looks good. The Southwick site had the sediment was a little bit more silty, a little bit more like this, and it was very similar. The site in Southwick had a lot of erosion. There was actually a very steep bank that was falling in. So we used the articulated concrete mats, and you know just what Inigo was talking about. That silted in very, very well. So that after about 2 years, you'd really have to stand over the stream and look down in order to even see some of the squares from the articulated concrete mats. The Tieringham site was a little bit different. That one, like I said, was a little bit more rocky. And so what was done there was there was actually some stones that were put back on top. And you know some of the finds, that was more of like a sand and gravel type stuff that was coming down off of a mountain that was actually up by the Appalachian Trail. But so that was more sand and gravel that kind of filtered in and filled in the holes.
So this is more of a finds environment type of stream.
It actually works quite well in both. And then there's actually, well, it wasn't in a stream, but there was one in Tallinger Otis, right by the town line there last year.
That one was on a slope heading down to a street.
Yeah,
that was
so,
in Talent.
Yeah, sorry, it was right near the town line. I didn't remember which town it was. But that one in particular didn't cross a stream, but it was on a slope. The slope was eroding. It was actually ATVs and dirt bikes were tearing up our hillside and caused erosion. And what we did is we went in there, we put there. And that was another situation where it worked out well because these hold very well, and then you can cover them back up, is that we didn't have to go back in and put 3 feet of cover there because you could, again, go in and just put, you know, foot and a half of cover and then, you know, cover back up and it'll still hold very well.
So the purpose of the geotextile is to prevent plant growth through that, or is it?
No, the purpose of that is to prevent undercutting.
Fine, Sir Travis. So it is a geotextile.
So is that geotextile underneath submar mat system, is it impermeable? Or is it just a tight weave?
It's more of a tight weave.
Okay. I mean, we're not talking thick plastic.
No.
No. We're not talking.
So it's a textile rather than. Okay.
Is it
like that big? Because
obviously
it's
different.
Similar to that, yes.
Yeah.
So it'll prevent undercutting, but no, it won't. How to say it? It's kind of in the middle there.
It'll be a durable fabric.
Yes, it would be an easier way to put it. Yes.
When we were out in the field Tuesday. Mike Tuhill was there from BSC, and just so that you know, they're proposing this work during low flow, and also when they do that, they will be diverting the stream through, you know, a pump system and a filter sack at the end, on the downstream side. What else did I want to say? And the duration of the construction would be about 2 weeks.
Stess, the plainly the obvious question that I know the answer to. I think I know the answer to, but we'll ask it anyways. The pipe being exposed, I mean, it's not meant to span across a stream. It's not meant to have the space underneath it. It's not meant to have flow and potentially debris hitting it. You know, that's, you're considering this, it's at risk right now, essentially, right? That's why we need to cover it?
Correct.
Just, you know, obviously, the solution isn't ideal having to raise the stream bed, but
yeah.
That's obviously, in my opinion at least,
yeah.
A lot better than what the risk associated with
leaving
the pipe exposed.
Right now, it's not in an unsafe condition, but with continued debris and stuff, it, you know, we want to correct it before it becomes an unsafe condition.
The metal on the flats, the wetland side is exposed. On the other side, it's a steep it's just a bank.
Yeah.
It's not exposed there.
Can I ask this is just something I thought of after we left the site visit. Are you going to remove the concrete encasement that's on the pipe currently, or is that going to remain?
That will remain. So that'll just be extra protection.
So if there is, for those who went on the site visit, and I'm sorry I couldn't go, is there sufficient area upstream of this pipe for that sort of damming ponding effect that's going to happen? Or is that going to interfere with anybody's house? Or is
no,
that
I checked out the banks, and it seemed like the bank was higher than the top of the pipe right now. I'm not sure it's higher than what they're proposing, 10 inches. I think it's 10 inches plus the matting.
The 10 inches includes the
matting. Okay. So you're probably going to create an impoundment area above the bank of the stream channel that exists right now. One side is lower than the other, so what are the two roads? Lucy Road side is lower.
So
east-west high.
All
right. Chuck, do you want to go to the phones? Because there might be a picture kind of the low-lying area. I would say there's probably a 25 to 30-foot riparian zone on that side before you reach the backs of the homes along Beaver. Maybe that one. A couple more? Yes. So this is our low-lying area. And, this is a shed or an outbuilding, and it does look almost like it's up on something, you know, so this area may be prone to flooding in larger storms. And so we just assumed it will kind of cut into the low-lying area and back down to the...
So I guess I'm just going to reiterate just one thing that maybe you can... if the engineer is present, I'm sorry, forgive me if I don't know that already, or ask the designing team if, just this question, if anything additionally porous can be more porous versus less porous be put around that pipe, does that satisfy your requirements for safety? And for structure, because if that, even with the siltation that happens there, if the capacity of that new dam area has a large capacity to store or transmit water through it, I think that should be taken advantage of to minimize potential flooding behind it. So it's just a question I have. You're nodding, so I'm thinking you're understanding.
I do understand.
Yeah,
okay. We would probably have to ask a submar representative.
I think we'd have to ask submar representative.
Or a pipeline engineering, yeah.
So potentially like a permeable, that soil would be permeable, and then the, you know, something
soil,
that
the
geotextile would,
gravel,
something that it could
like
filter, still filter that you wouldn't lose it,
almost,
but,
yeah.
But it would still
or
let water
sand,
flow.
Whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm mixture of coarse sand and gravel? I mean, I don't know. I'm just asking.
I think it's worth it considering that this is potentially backing this area up.
Yeah. Chuck, do you have any questions or comments?
Yeah, a couple questions. I think first, is this the only solution to this problem? I mean, how come we're not? Why are we doing this? And why aren't you trenching and getting the pipe underneath the stream? We don't have all these problems that we've just been talking about. And if there's no way to solve that, you started to talk about a low flow channel, which I was asking about because that's what's out there now. And I was wondering if that you figured out a way to do that. But first, why is this the solution that you're using?
Okay.
I guess we were brainstorming. We thought about what about kind of making it an almost like an aqueduct or a viaduct of some sort, like raised up on stilts in a way, but that still kind of leaves it open to large debris coming down the stream channel. We considered lowering the pipe, but that's
if we lowered the pipe, we would be, I don't know if the pictures show it upstream and downstream. I don't think they did.
This is best one for that.
Okay, so that's going across. So if we were to lower the pipe, because of the hillsides and the driveways and stuff, we'd have to go significantly further on either side, like potentially up to 100 feet further on either side. So we would have to go, I'm trying to get my bearing straight, north versus south.
So this is the eastern bank and this is the western bank.
Okay, so if you went for the western bank, we would have to go clear across the driveway and into the wetland on the other side. If we went...
To get the slope you need to go under.
It's like a domino effect whenever you need to lower the pipe. It's not just there. You have to let go for it.
And you can't
elbow.
Yes. And then on the other side, because it rises up in elevation, again, we'd have to go probably another 100 feet further up in order to get that proper grade.
And you don't have, you're saying you don't have the easement, or you didn't even investigate that because of the space it required?
It's not necessarily the easement, it's the disruption to
neighbors.
So by lowering the pipe, you wouldn't change anything. You just literally trench it out and let the pipe settle down lower?
What we'd have to do, we'd have to put in what we call sags and overbends, which would be, down and over. So that takes a lot more room in order to do it.
That was exaggerated of what the sag and
overbend. That was exaggerated.
But you don't have a pipe stretcher, so I mean, it's obviously going to need. This is going to be some consideration for the.
For the stress factor, in some situations, which this isn't one of them. But if we have like a flat area, like a flat farm field or something to that effect, and just the top of the pipe is showing, we can trench out, put some weights on it, and actually, if the stress factor works, we can do that. This being an older pipe and this having, the changes in elevations, that just wouldn't work.
Sorry, all these questions.
Let me answer my other question first.
Go ahead, sorry.
Because this happens a little bit here. All right, I'm still not satisfied with that answer, but...
What's the other question?
The other question was, when we're out there, the stream we're looking at here isn't there, it's a lot lower. And that stream naturally created a low flow channel. And I was wondering if that was going to be part of this new articulated mat system. Can you get that to work, gas pipe, if you could figure that out? And I don't know if anyone looked at
it. Yeah, and from what Mike told us, is you're asking, like, if the over the top of the pipe, if rather than going straight across like it's shown, we put a little bend in there to allow channel. Easily done. That could be very easily done.
I guess the question I had was, what is the gas company's expectation of this pipe's lifetime?
As long as it's maintained, it can go for decades more, and that's part. part of the intent here is to not run into a situation where we'd have to go and, you know, replace a pipe. So
to get more into an administrative aspect, there was discussion a while ago about the asking for a variance associated with this. Okay, it's just the fees. I'm sorry to...
Oh, and also just the fact that there's no way to stay out of the 25-foot. We can't not disturb vegetation.
Yeah.
In my opinion, this is a borderline emergency situation.
I think this meets the requirements for the work.
We don't want this pipe exposed. Any longer.
Properly protected.
So it's an emergency.
Run through some pretty.
Is this about the fees?
This is about
easy
the work.
Easy terrain. What's the lifespan of a pipe like
going.
This? 100, 200 years? Or
I heard fees.
Of a pipeline?
There are two things about it.
Well,
to do the work.
There's pipelines that are in service now that are 100 years old. And they still run. And, you know, today's, for pipelines that have been built in the last 20 years, the technology just keeps getting better. So. As long as they're properly maintained and tested and repaired as necessary, decades, century, perhaps.
Is that pipe made out of steel?
Yes.
Yeah.
How thick is it?
This. It would be a few inches. It's probably. It varies. Being a more populated area, it's probably, if I had to guess, probably that thick.
Is gas passing through it on the inside of the road?
No.
So, maybe I'm missing it. I don't see much in here about, after work, after this is all said and done and complete, are there any plantings proposed? Are there, what's this going to look like when it's done, according to how it's proposed?
We do have the, erosion control blankets on the slope, and aluminum seed is usually the restoration method. Certainly, we can use wetland seed mix in the wetlands, typically they don't encourage woody vegetation over the pipe because of the systems.
Right.
So the goal is always to continue to maintain the right of way for herbaceous vegetation is fine, and there are shrubs in right-of-ways, but the goal is to have more of a grass and herbaceous type species, which is mostly what's there right now. Self cabbage, jewelweed.
The right-of-way gets mowed every 3 to 5 years, so shrubs would last. That's a USDOT requirement.
What's the disturbance going to look like to get in there and do this work?
It would look torn up for sure. There's the need to come down off the driveway, swamp mats for a temporary workspace and to avoid ruts in the wetland as they access the stream. Seeing it in action, it looks bad. due to a conservation eye, it looks bad. But when it's restored, it really does look in good form. The vegetation comes back quickly. And
so how much of this is bank disturbance?
I think we have 92 linear feet, 46 on each side. And that's assuming the mats, the erosion control blankets, the temporary disturbance, the rock grade. We kind of did more of the maximum impacts. It could be less as they do the work, but we kind of went to be on the conservative side of the maximum.
Should we discuss these variances?
So it's $17,000.
Do we have, was that table included in the application?
It was,
okay.
Yeah, it's probably towards the back.
I a question about the mat versus, because it was mentioned previously about I know why you don't want to dig this deeper, but, you know, why wouldn't you make this a high flyer? And as you're coming down that uphill bank, why wouldn't you actually take and bring it up over the surface of the water and then bring it under the road? Is there not enough head height below that road? Do you have to have a certain height above that, the pipe, to bring a road over the top of it?
Yes, and it depends. Well, there's kind of two factors there. One, yes, we would definitely want 3 feet of cover being a driveway, but it also comes into load factor as to the weight of vehicles that would be passing over
right.
the pipeline.
So that you'd have to have 3 feet?
Typically, yes. Because based on, because the two main governing bodies that oversee natural gas pipelines are the U.S. Department of Transportation, which oversees the interstate transport of natural gas, and the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. And they each have their safety standards that we need to abide by.
Because I know you have the uphill side. It's just that for the drive, I call it a roadway. It is a roadway, but it's really more of a driveway. It serves like three houses, I think, up there. Is that you? Is that your house?
On the uphill side.
Uphill side. But, you know, if it serves one, we're not going to be having cement trucks passing this thing, you know, constantly. And actually, that is in a natural swale. It actually goes uphill on the other side of that. But,
yeah.
There's a pipeline that's similar to this. It's at the end of the Mystic Lakes over in Arlington. That's up in the air, and it's encased in a concrete column that goes over Mill Brook. So, that's pretty close to the water. I mean, when you have severe flooding, it actually hits that concrete abutment. But it's been there for 40 years. It hasn't. Any problems yet? It would seem to me that with all the digging and the mats and etc. and working with the wet and the water, diverting the water, that would seem to me to be easier to bring it up out of the water rather than bringing something over it. That's just my thought.
And I can't cite the actual regulation or what's going on, but. Just kind of as an example, in the past, it was pretty common for pipelines to be attached to bridges.
Right.
After 9/11, heightened security, I've worked on quite a number of projects where the pipes were now taken off of bridges and then put back under the rivers. And when you have a pipe above ground, you also have the safety aspect, being a neighborhood where you got
yep.
kids out there playing and
yeah.
using it as a bridge and walking across it, and it poses other challenges.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure that was one of the metrics that was investigated. That was just
yeah.
something that I was curious about as to why you wouldn't go uphill rather than burying it underneath
yeah.
the mats.
Are we going to talk about the fees?
Before we talk about that, do we want to open it up to, because the fees are part of the work that's potentially being done, do we want to open it up to the public to come?
Sure, Mike. Sir?
Thank you. John Livens, 149 Eastway. As I mentioned, on the East Bank, up over the hill. And that particular stream, as you mentioned, actually works pretty well the way it is. And a lot of wildlife down on that stream bed. And I guess I have the same question, which is, you have this pipe that now is exposed. And the problem is, you mentioned that some of the exposed steel, there's degradation. Well, any corrosion that starts is going to continue. And if you actually put something over it, you're not necessarily protecting the corrosion or stopping the corrosion from happening. So the question is, are we putting a band-aid over something that could be a bigger problem? Rather than having it visible and having something up in the air that you actually can see, make sure that the water goes under. My concern is, are we going to create this enormous drain system for something that maybe is overkill for the problem? It seems to me that, you know, this, I haven't seen that pipe change in the 12 years I've lived at that address. It's approximately the same. Okay, and it's certainly not the Twin Towers. We certainly don't have the kind of load and the concern of traffic over the small bridge that serves one single family home. So again, I look at this and I say, it looks like, you know, it looks like the applicant's trying to do something to say, we're gonna do something to protect the pipe. I'm just wondering if it's really the best solution to the problem that exists.
Well, do I address that?
Sure.
Yes. Well, one of the things that we'll also be doing is what was briefly discussed earlier. We'll have sandbag dam upstream and downstream during construction to isolate it so that we'll be working in dry conditions. As part of that, the pipeline will be inspected. And so if there is any areas of corrosion identified, we'll be able to address it then. And that will probably be additional coating on the pipeline. Whether it be the coating, what's the wrapping called?
Yeah, I mean, I just like the wax wrapping.
Yeah,
coating
yeah, but you know, there's, I'm totally drawn a blank on the, but basically, it would be inspected, it would be recoated as necessary, and then it'd be the long-term solution would be to put the mats as we're discussing. So the last thing we want to do is just put a band-aid on the
problem. Will that hurt? I mean, one of the things, if I may, to take a question, one of the things I've heard is that you're actually monitoring the integrity of that pipe, and that's one of the reasons why you want to keep it clear around that right away.
Correct.
But does that, I mean, how do you see through this big concrete overlay?
It's
an internal, they have internal systems.
Yeah, so. So there would be two ways. One would be there'd be a visual inspection from the outside. Now, in addition, one of the USDOT requirements is that we run an inline inspection tool through the pipeline, and that is typically every 7 years. And what that does is that will pick up any dents, any corrosion, any imperfection in the pipeline. And then, so when those are identified, we can go in there and correct it.
Gotcha.
So it's like an internal morphology.
Correct. Yeah, it's very sensitive. Like it'll pick up every weld, every weld of that pipeline. So we can identify that because we know that they're 40-foot length. So every 40 feet, it's gonna pick up the weld. So it's sensitive enough that it will identify those areas.
And that's part of like the whole system, the constant monitoring system. Pipe gets dug up throughout the state, you know, at regular intervals whenever these systems find a ding or possibly even like a thinning of the pipeline wall, like that these systems pick it up and then crews physically go in, dig it out, inspect it, check it, wrap it. If they have to replace a piece of pipe, they do. It's all part of the anomaly program that they have. And then they have corrosion protection along the pipe and remote ground vents to keep the soil potential from, you know, eating away at the steel over time. And so a lot of systems in place to protect
like
that way.
I guess I'm still kind of going back to some of these commission members have said that, you know, again, as we have a stream that's functioning, is there a different way to do this? So you actually have better monitoring of that, of the integrity of it, or maybe you encase it in something so that it's protected from the neighborhood kids walking on it, which might happen occasionally. But, you know, again, I don't know if it's a big hazard out of the water. Is it a bigger deal to actually try to do all you're doing and end up with unintended consequences of rerouting the stream?
I just have a Will Finch, 51 Mill Street. I just have a comment about the fees. It seemed to me that since there's a permanent alteration of the stream bed, that at least half of the fees should be. I could see if they were digging up the stream bed and working on it, then putting it back the way it was, you know, you'd have a better argument for the way it feels. That's all I feel.
That's an interesting comment.
Yep, another interesting thing. The project manager on this project had looked at some historical show this stream on the USGS, and it did show up in the next series from the 1960s, and you know, it is mapped as perennial at this time, and you know, I think just the residential development coming up and around the area, over time, you know, that tends to incise the stream, make the bank steeper, lower the profile of the stream, and it has a lot to do, I think, with just runoff, and it seems like just residential development runoff is getting maybe piped in that direction. I ran stream stats on it, and it is just below half a square mile of drainage area, which the half, if you were trying to determine if an intermittent stream was perennial, you would look for that half mile and half square mile drainage area, as well as, you know, the low flow. And but being perennial, it's perennial. You know, we're not questioning that. But it did show on stream stats, you know, unmapped USGS wise, but mapped on stream stats, that the drainage area is coming in from eastern residential development in that direction, as well as it just kind of originates. You know, there's no real, the connection upstream isn't clear. It just basically originates in this residential area.
You mentioned about the low flow season, and then I guess the question is again, what for people not involved in what the flow seasons are? When would that be? And then also, how would you access that site?
Typically, low flow is August. Well, the USGS Army Corps sets it July 1st to September 30th. So usually the driest time of the year.
So in the upper months.
So we're looking August, September for.
And would that be so? When you set this up, as you're mentioning about a 92 foot wide area, are you all accessing this from the driveway off the?
And it's actually not 92 feet wide. It's 92 is the addition of the 46 meter feet on one bank plus the 46. Like they were asking about bank capacity, that's the 92. So it's 46 feet approximately wide on each.
That's the stream bed corridor, isn't it?
Yes.
Brought up a good point that this is permanent alteration of fairly natural stream bed on either side and bank. And when you look at the square footage and the cost, it was about $14,000.
And that includes, that does include any square footage of temporary swamp mats and erosion control blankets. So that's what that's coming off of, because it's a temporary and permanently altered number. So I do have another table in here that kind of breaks down the actual impacts by how they were impacted. So maybe there's somewhere in there where the erosion control blankets, the temporary alteration, maybe
is that on our notice of intent?
Yes, it's in the narrative under section 3.2, page 4 of the narrative.
Could you just go through those?
Sure.
Left my stuff at work, so.
So, well, maybe on the BBW is the best place to discuss it, because there's we have 776 square feet of BBW.
Do you want my copy? Don't mind. Thank you very much.
The installation of the articulated mats is 109. Of that 776, temporary grading to kind of anchor in and trench in the mat would be 93 square feet. Temporary disturbance with the erosion control blanket is 279, and potential additional workspace on the swamp mats is 295. So, you know, basically two-thirds of that 776, maybe even more, is related to temporary impacts. So maybe if there's a way to, you know, relieve the temporary impact numbers, that might make a dent in the total.
So you're talking about the 93, the 279, and the 295?
Yeah.
So the Inland Bank is, is what it is. It's 92 linear feet, 46 linear feet on each bank. And then land under water is 550.
That kind of is what it
yeah.
is as well. We know the exception of the rock grade, that's, you know, that's kind of to alleviate any scour, which there is scour now. But yeah, that's kind of a firm number in a way.
The riverfront area.
And the riverfront area isn't associated with the fee, but the 25-foot buffer zone.
Was 790 square feet.
Oh, so the buffer zone is the 100-foot buffer zone. It looks like it doesn't necessarily need to go to the 25-foot, even though most of the work is. So we have about $1,000 worth of buffer zone impacts. And we did pay, I believe it was $750 total for the break between the state's share and the town's share of the Wetland Protection Act form. So that's $750 there, but that's not doesn't look significant. Just so.
Sorry, so I'm sure you just said this,
that's
and
okay.
I'm there's this 14,000 of older, 14,586. That's 1,326 square feet of disturbance.
That it's all broken down in different ways. The bylaw requires $11 per linear foot of bank, $11 per square foot of land underwater or marine vegetated wetland, whether it's temporary or permanent. It's $11 per square foot.
Yep.
And then anything in the 100-foot buffer zone is $1.25 per square foot. So there's about $1,000 of buffer zone.
Yeah, but that's not included in this 14,000 number, right?
Right, that's right. Yes, so the 14,000, you're right, is basically that 13. Yes. Sorry for the
problems.
So under J, work in freshwater, wetland, wet meadow, da 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 da. It's 14,586. When you were going through the temporary, you had a kind of a breakdown between permanent. No, talk about
okay.
This one. J.
Yeah, all right. So
you had some idea of what was temporary, what was permanent.
Yes.
It was like two-thirds?
I'd say, maybe even three-quarters is temporary for the wetland, but then if you're adding in the land underwater as well, then maybe it's more like half of that number then. So the 550 would stay unless you want to relieve the rock grade. And then I'd say about
it would
be just about half.
So it's the 550 plus the 776. The temporary is
okay.
93, 279, 295, which
is
667.
Is that about half?
It's
okay.
So basically,
let's go E is commercial industrial.
Sure.
That's $1,000. That is what it is. temporary or permanent alteration under G. Do you know what the breakdown is on that? Let's skip that one, and let's K, work in bank. It is what it is. 1012. Let's work on J, and if that's half.
So it's 600. If you include the 550.
Where you get the 550?
Land underwater. That's the second one on the table.
Not there. The other table.
Yeah. Okay. Are you agreement?
It's
about 50 half.
Then. Being it, and then you add the 109 of the permanent change of substrate. That's 659. That comes out to 7,249, more or less half.
Okay. 7,249, okay, and then the rest of them stay the same.
All right.
You guys all right with that?
Well, we kind of
yes.
did something
I'm
like
fine.
That in a general way. Didn't we?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's
yeah.
exactly what we did.
Yeah.
Exactly. So we've kind of.
I did the math. I checked. I can't believe it's. I got the same numbers that you did. So.
So right. So what would we talk about for a fee now?
It's going to be a total of about 10,000.
Yep. Which one?
U.S. It would be about 10,200.
U.S.
dollars.
Oh,
total. Total.
Yeah.
All right.
Let's move on.
What?
Patience. So, I would make this as a separate motion.
Certainly.
I make a motion that we adjust the fees to just the permanent work and as part of the freshwater, wetland, yada, yada, yada. Item J.
Okay. Do I hear a second?
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Make motions too.
You're so good at it.
In my mind, there's a couple outstanding technical questions that I think still need to be addressed. Alternatives have been brought up and discussed, and it seems to be a concern a lot of people have. Feasible alternatives besides putting in the mat and the dam. The question about the engineering of the materials within the dam. Any other notes you've taken tonight? I want to do an official summary.
Maybe a clear understanding of what the impoundment area is going to look like.
Yeah.
A planting.
I think that's a good
how
idea.
Far it extends back and how much where the new, I don't know, seasonal high water would be based on, you know, where it's at now. Like I said, one side of the street's not going to have a problem eastward, but the other side. It's lower, and I think there's some timbers out there, and I think that those are going to get submerged.
Also, some kind of restoration after construction of the wetland area,
right?
Where you propose to put the wood mats, so it'll be squished.
And Chuck, to your point, maybe something. Like you were saying, is it possible to create a low flow? You know, you have on your detail a upstream to downstream section here.
Yeah.
Can you do something like if there's no other engineering solution to this problem, anything different? Is there like something across section across the pipe? That shows that notch,
yeah.
That lower.
Putting that channel in there is easy. That's, you know, that's one of the benefits of those is that you can, you know, actually mold them to the contour that you'd like.
Can you make it about 5 foot deep by about 10 or 15 foot wide?
5 foot deep?
Oh, sorry, so five inches deep.
5 inches
by
deep?
About 15 inches wide.
Yeah, that's pretty. You're gonna be scared there. I was like,
because that's what's there right now. That low area is about 5 inches, maybe a little bit more. It's about, you know, it's about that wide. It's probably more than 15
okay.
inches.
A weird.
And then you're kind of recreating that natural condition.
Yeah, I'm
5 feet.
Not so happy with damming it, you know, where it's been draining. But
okay,
see
do
what
we have
they
a motion to continue?
I make a motion to continue.
I realize that, but the ramifications.
Did you have a second?
All right, no problem.
All those in favor?
Numbers are in there too, so I don't know if that will help.
All right. Excellent, thank you.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
Thanks for letting me use it.
Can I just run through the notes you were looking for and make sure more details on how permeable we can get to cover over the pipe, including the fabric, the permeability of the fabric. Show a cross section of the low flow channel in detail. Get an idea of the impoundment area, so some sort of idea of the extent that area might flood or how, you know, and greater details on the alternative analysis. Is there something about restoration you wanted to know?
Restoration plan.
You know, the wetland that you're going to put the mats on?
Yeah.
Be a little bit more specific on what you are proposing.
So show a better representation of where swamp mats and things like that would be? Or
that would be great too, but also
how much fill?
After construction, how do you propose to restore that area?
This is even like the wetland mix, where you put on wetland mix, where you put on, yeah.
Right.
What type of soil, what's the finished grade going to look like? What's it going to look like after?
Right. Hey, Kathy, do you guys have a wetland seed mix that you guys like?
We have a whole list of native plants that we...
We don't have a seed mix.
Okay.
I don't think we...
Okay, but you have a list of native plants. Is that on your webpage or something?
It's on there, yeah.
Okay.
All
right.
It is?
It is? Okay.
It's right under the
tree policy.
The tree policy is there.
Yeah, definitely.
You're here, we can't.
Thank you very much.
All right, so I assume this is being continued to the next meeting?
Correct. Well, if you can provide us with the information in 2 weeks, and Chuck, when would they have to have the information to you?
Distribution goes out next Wednesday. Can you make that?
Do you want to do
you were doing it on the 4th.
Yeah, what's going on?
Yeah, good point.
If you can make the next meeting, next
get all the information to you on the night of the next meeting.
Or probably we want to get a couple
well,
of
we
prior
need to review the notes. So if you can get it to me, whenever you can get it to me, the commission's going to need to review it. So if you can't make next week by Thursday, at the latest. And you can't review it for the next meeting. So it's really going to drive that train.
Okay. And if the commission's satisfied at the next, if the materials you would have to wait for like second meeting in July, just in case, then the commission, if they're satisfied, there is an additional continuance, because then you'll need to draft up the order like you did for the meeting before us. So are we looking in like maybe August or?
You just don't draft the order until the hearing's closed.
But there was a continuance to
time
to draft it and then review it. So are we looking at like we're looking at August maybe before there could be a...
I think you are looking at it. If you can't get the materials to us next week, it's the first meeting in August to have the
that's when we would.
So if that works.
That would probably work.
Okay.
The 21.
next week, but I can't promise that one. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You know, I'm gonna change up the old new business a little bit and do the certificate of compliance for 270.
So that'll be the meeting on the 26th.
I'm losing everybody.
Do what?
Certificate of compliance for Sunnyside Ave. We do that one. Chuck, we
might do that one last.
Do we want to do
that? Okay, that's what he's waiting for.
Thank you.
Thank you.
He's so mean.
I received what I wanted from Libby Wallace. She needed to put infiltration on the plan. And the erosion material was removed in the nylon, what is that stuff called? The nylon outer matting to that was removed from it in the, and then it was raked out.
Okay.
So what we have to find, and I think there was some miscommunication about the pile of yard waste. So that turned into a bush from what we were looking at that had just died off. So I don't know how that happened, but maybe we should look at that a little more. So I recommend that we that you guys approve and issue the certificate of compliance.
This is the pool.
This is the one with the pool,
okay.
And in the fence completely around.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. No, I just want to make sure I was thinking right.
Right. Hear a motion.
So moved.
Those in favor? Okay.
Thank you for waiting.
Oh. Thank you. So, Will, I assume you have Trails Committee requests.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, so
I don't want to keep you any longer.
So what we're proposing, could you get a copy of this?
Yeah.
It's just a map of the town for us. But there's an existing boardwalk that the Boy Scouts have been building over the last probably 10 years. And it's just about completed, and they thought they're completed at the east end, but in recent years.
Yeah, the west end has to be rebuilt.
Well, the west end does need to be extended to probably another 20 feet, because either the conditions have changed since we gave the Boy Scouts their information or whatever. They didn't quite make it as long as we had requested. But anyways, this is the east end, and there's the boardwalk, the last 10-foot section of boardwalk just kind of dies down into the muck. And then there's another 10 feet of mucky trail before you really get to upland. So what we're proposing is to lift that last 10-foot section that's there up out of the muck, put new supports under it so there's airspace under it, and then add another 10-foot section that will also be suspended above the mud or wetland, and then it will end beyond where it has ever gotten wet in the past.
How high are you moving it up, Hank?
It's the highest, well, right now there's probably about 8-inch supports underneath it. So we will be coming, where it dives down into the muck, it'll be coming up at least 8 inches, and it'll continue going straight until it meets the bank or the end of the wetland coming up. And the
part that we lift up, we're gonna have to put those, the plastic pipe underneath to support that part, probably two. And then the new part that we're building will either have those plastic pipes or, you know, towards the end, it's not gonna be up very much above where it's dry, so we probably can get by with a pressure treated 4x4 going laterally, and then 4x4 sleepers on top of that.
So how much additional boardwalk going from the current spot to up bank?
It'll be 10 feet additional, so one 10-foot section, 4 feet wide to match the existing plastic Trex type decking.
Talking like a, I don't want to get too exact, but how steep do you think it's going to?
It'll be almost level.
Oh.
In fact, the ramp that's coming down, that'll be brought up to just about level, then it will continue at that level and then meet the trail where it's always dry.
And the pipes you're putting underneath, are those the big corrugated,
yeah,
like pass-through,
yeah,
pipes that,
yeah,
like I think Mark Wetzel,
right, yeah,
designed?
Yeah, we've done those plans many times, and the Boy Scouts have used them.
Are those holding up pretty well?
Yeah, they are. And they don't seem to sink into the muck. I know we had a lot of, well, this, on this, what we call Alligator Alley, but the original construction, the boardwalk sections were supported with cinder blocks, and it's just too small of a footprint,
yeah,
and they just sink into the muck.
Yeah.
And so we, last spring, was last fall, I forget when it was, we spent a day out there lifting up sections that had sagged, become disconnected, and added either pipes, or we also use we have these 6x8 inch plastic, I don't know, it's timbers, but they're plastic that we got from the town that had used around a playground. Again, it spreads out the load quite a bit in the muck. So that's the goal. So we probably won't do this work until the dry season, August, September.
Did you
set the tentative work date as Saturday, July 8th?
Well, that was the initial hope.
Yeah.
But Trails Committee themselves are not available on that date. And so we did do some nice fundraising at Friends and Family Day. We got about $120 for donations.
Nice.
That was all approved above board by the staff at Town Hall. So basically, we sold a piece of decking for $10. You know, it worked pretty well. It's amazing.
Yeah.
You get to write your name on the deck.
Yeah, you sign your name on the deck. It's going to be underneath though, so you won't see your name.
So they rip it up. And
that's why I didn't buy any.
You know, usually for these types of projects, we ask the applicants to provide details and specs and drawings and all that sort of stuff. Will's probably done more trail work and rehab work than.
And more commission work than.
And more commission work than most others. So I don't need to see a spec. I just thought I'd mention that.
Will we trust?
I thought this would be
done under our.
It's a townwide
permit, right?
It's a townwide permit. Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's an existing trail.
With the Boy Scouts usually come in.
Yeah.
And he was there for the crafting of the original design of the decking. Mm-hmm. I've been with him when he's built some of these decks, so.
I don't have
vouch for.
I'm just saying for me. I'm speaking for myself.
I'm making a motion to approve. It's pretty straightforward.
Here, a second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Will.
Thanks for your patience.
You're free to stay.
Yeah, I know.
All right, well, thank you and good night.
Just do you mind sending Chuck an email just letting us know when it's happening?
When it's happening, yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, good.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Thanks.
2017-06-37 Pinevale.
McCracken?
Yep.
So that was closed, and I prepared the determination, so it just needs to be signed. Make a motion to issue. This is a shed that's 35 feet away from the wetlands at 37 Pinevale. It's going to be on 6 sonotubes.
Oh, okay. The, do we have removal of the yard waste in there?
We have it in there, but it does belong to his brother.
His brother.
So,
still in the family.
See how
right?
enforceable that is. All
right.
Yeah.
And do we have a certificate of compliance for 310 South Street?
We do. 310 South Street complied with everything we asked them to do, which was to put the limit of work or the limit of lawn at the town line, which is approximately on the 25-foot line, and not mow in back of it. We asked them to move a granite bound and plant a tree. They complied with all that pretty quickly, and check that out, and I recommend that we issue this certificate of compliance to that project.
Make a motion to issue.
Second.
All those in favor? The amendment to the order of conditions 270-064 306 Main Street.
So what we're going to do is we're going to the order of conditions, which was the Getty spill cleanup, which was 270-492. The only part of that that was not completed was the planting plan. There's actually a plan, and it's mentioned in the order of conditions. We are going to take that off the order and add it to the expanded Pizza World site order, which is 270-0641. So this just documents what we're doing and the steps that are going to be taken afterwards. We're going to modify the plan. It's just what I said. Then the original record the original modifications at the Registry of Deeds. So this will be recorded.
Even if it's
what you're signing, it has a section to sign.
So technically, though, this is a minor plan change. No.
Yeah, I guess so. I don't.
Another one would be a minor plan change.
This is not considered minor. This is just
reissuing of the
weird. We're making a change and we're recording it.
Okay.
So now the
well, we closed the other one, right?
Nope, everything's still open. Well,
my notes from the last time say you were going to consolidate the order of conditions into one amended final minor plan change that will get recorded.
This is what I meant. This plan change.
Okay.
So this is the plan change,
yeah.
And then eventually we will close the other ones that are not.
We'll be issuing certificates of compliance to the other two at the next meeting once this is recorded.
Okay.
And that's step 1, 2, and 3 at the bottom.
Okay.
Vote on that, Chuck?
Yeah, it'd be nice to
make a motion to issue.
No second. All in favor.
Make a motion to approve the plan change. That's what you want to do. But not issuing a plan change.
As Chuck indicated, I make a motion to approve the minor plan change.
Whatever Mike said,
great.
I second that.
Great.
We need a lawyer on this.
No, we don't. It could be painful.
Simpson was done.
Coming back.
Anything good in there?
Mm-hmm.
All the good stuff, huh?
Mm-hmm. this site walk?
We did.
I wait till I put half of that little crusty bar in my mouth. Anyway, on June 15th, I met with representatives from Millbrook Construction, Artis, Hayes Engineering, and the Artis site themselves at 1100 Main Street. And all of the things that were discussed after our last site visit out there last September, and several of the things that were discussed at that time were already done. Some of them were not. Some of those being installing the granite bounds along the Cookie side of the property, along the driveway, and also installing signs on top of those granite bounds. I observed that pond area to be a vibrant, well-vegetated and established wetland area. Looked good to me. Other than the thing was is that one of the things that we had discussed, and I know that Chuck had passed on to the representative from Hayes Engineering, is that we had talked about joining the lower pond area and that upper pond area, that finger that goes towards Main Street. That had not been done. There were some a lot of wetland plants and some small shrubs that actually had been planted along the berm that had been placed there. They were living. They looked really good other than the succulents that the deer had browsed down to about a half inch height. So the deer, I guess, liked them. That looked good. The granite bound or the concrete bound that was close to the tree that was at the edge of that finger area that we had asked to be moved was not moved. The representative from Delbrook said that that could be done. The vegetated area that was outside the 8-foot fence that was over on the north side of the property looked pretty good. There were bushes there that hadn't been there in my last visit. Some of them were rhododendrons and some were white cedars. I don't know how long the white cedars had been planted there, but there was actually deer tracks in the mulch around the white cedars, and the deer hadn't been browsing them at all, right? Which really surprised me that if they'd put them in the day before that. But the rhododendrons that they had actually planted were not living. The representative from Artis had said to me that they had a landscape architect that they were consulting as to what they were going to replant those rhododendrons that were not successfully growing. I had spoken to the representative from Hayes Engineering about the spring survivability report, and she actually said to me that she would send it to Chuck as soon as they had it, and I actually received a copy, which I believe all the rest of you did as well, by email, and it pretty much lays out exactly what was there on the site that I observed. The only thing that wasn't the same, and it was something that this person, which is Libby Wallace, said to me that the last time that she had been there, that the upper area was actually full of water. In the pictures that were shown on her survivability report actually bear that out, that there is water in that upper area. So
this is the upper area that we think is higher than it's looked.
Yes, and when I looked at, there was an as-built plan, and the as-built plan showed that the upper area was only 0.02 inches difference in grade elevation between the cusp of the pond and that upper area, probably about halfway up that finger. And you could certainly see without using a transit that that was not the case. Bearing out with what happened to the water that was there as well. The representative from Delbrook, it's my understanding that the representative of Delbrook, and that day he told me that he was going to contact Chuck, and in subsequent conversation that his plan was that they were gonna have a wait and see attitude to see if that upper area survives and becomes a viable and healthy vegetated wetland area. At this point, I don't think the water was out of there long enough. The bottom of that was still pretty muddy. So when we get into the dark days of summer, I really don't know what's gonna happen to that, but they were willing to wait to see what happened without going in there and rebaiting the level of the ground so that it was all contiguous. So
I guess that means we're gonna wait and see for this,
yeah.
The closure?
That's what they wanted to do. They really didn't wanna, there was a representative from Lynch Construction there, and both the representative from Lynch Construction and the representative from Delbrook. Both said that they felt that it was going to do more harm than good to actually bring a big machine in there and reach over in there and try and rebate the...
A big machine?
Yeah, well, that's
it's
what
like
they said.
Everything's done with big machines.
Okay. Excavator. So there are other ways, obviously, to do it, but that's what they said. There was one other thing that was brought up there at the same meeting, and it had to do with town engineering. There were two... there are people that live across the street from that site on Willard Road or Willard Street. On the corner of Willard Street, there's two catch basins that go down into a common catch basin. And a pipe then goes from that catch basin and traverses, bisects Route 28, under Route 28, goes underneath the front area of the artist's developed site. And goes, it's supposed to go into that pond and dump in that pond and recharge that pond. Well, that pipe is either blocked or it's broken. The town of Reading sent a high pressure water jet through the pipe, and it only got to a certain level. And there are two possibilities that they surmise that one, it's at a transition point where it goes from a 2x2 foot red brick waterway into a 10-inch welded pipe, and it could have been hitting the edge of that, or it might be blocked at that point or crushed. They were going to televise it to see what happened, so that the end of that street and the houses, there's a front yard, side yard and a backyard of two of the houses that abut the end of that street that are actually flooding at high water times, so they want to be able to correct that. And the town engineers and the representative from Delbrook and the representative from Lynch Construction are working on that. The last that I was told was that the representative from Lynch Construction was going to televise the pipe to see if they could determine whether the pipe was crushed or whether it was just blocked at the outfall at the pond. So. And that obviously the outfall that goes into that pond will also serve to recharge the pond as well with water.
Okay. So I just want to comment that regarding this project, I think as long as the responsible subcontractors are still under the gun to work at this site, we can potentially wait and see, but we should close the issues before they're off-site, completely and totally off the project. You know what I mean? Once they're gone, Artis is going to have nobody to turn to fix our problems that are outstanding. And I could see a wait and see going into a we are never going to really deal with this kind of thing based on their history so far. They did a lot of stuff up front, but now we've been waiting and seeing for quite a long time. Over a year, Chuck?
I don't have, they requested a certificate of compliance sometime last year.
But when did they get occupancy? Years?
No, it began first of the year.
Okay, well, I guess I wasn't too aware.
I think this was definitely the first winter. I mean, maybe, you know, coming up to the first of the year, I can't remember exactly when that happened. But I
just want to know what sort of time window we have in front of us to get these issues dealt with and ask them that question.
There's really no issues right now. I mean, that pond, that connectivity could work. I mean, it seems like it's working right now. And everyone's willing to wait. So that could be fine. We have more money than it needs to replant it or you know, excavate it. But I don't think we're going to be excavating it if that needs to be done. But we have a wait and see attitude. So next year, when we get our second and final survivability report, we can make a decision.
Yeah. So the survivability goes out not 3 years, but 2 years.
It's just two.
It's just two. Did we do 3 years for?
I think maybe mentioned three, but I thought. It was
I always thought it was 3 years. I thought it was.
It's usually three for invasive removal and two for wetland mitigation.
Oh. I can't
one
get
of the
that
other
level
things
of detail.
That kind of another fly in the ointment here is that if they reconnect that pipe, we don't know what the recharging of that pond is going to do to bridge the gap between those upper and lower areas either. So that could artificially raise the level of the other.
The actions with that pipe could change what's going on up over there
right
now.
Well, it should add water based on those two houses getting flooded.
I don't think it's going to raise it.
Not that much. Only when it rains.
Which is what it's for.
Yeah.
That's unusual, though. We ask them to connect those two, and then they have this elevated section, which makes no sense. It just really doesn't. And they're saying, oh, we shot it again, and it might be, you know, they wanted to take it down by, you know, an inch, maybe 2 inches in one corner, and it looks like it's going to go down, you know, 8 inches, you know, maybe
right.
more.
Right.
So, that, and I guess what we found out was at the site visit for Tennessee Gas that Mike Toolhill actually didn't design it, but he worked on it, he said. And he was willing to go over there and check it out, so I was going to follow up with him and ask him what he thought.
I think one of the other things with the contractors, I mean, I don't know that they are even on, they maybe just be going out to the site at this point. I don't know that they're definitely on board. Still, I mean, it's probably
I don't know.
Well, I don't think Artis would want a certificate of compliance, for sure. You know, that's not an issue right now. People are responding to what we need because we're working in tandem. And it didn't even need this, but we are working in tandem with the engineering department, but I think it's the Conservation Commission that has all the leverage right now.
Right.
So far, so good.
Okay. Right, moving on, Friends and Family Day recap.
Well, I sent you an email, but I will recap my email. The setup was great. Not a problem. I was sheltered from the rain, and thank you to Harry, Mike, and Becky for checking in on it and setting it up and making it. Yeah, but you checked in on it, so you know, and making it handoff ready. So in past years, I think we just overloaded the table with a lot of paperwork and posters and stuff like that. And this year, there was a little bit less on the table, but it seemed to draw a little bit more curiosity. So
less is more.
And a lot of people talked to that Redding mounted map generated by the GIS department. That's a really, really useful tool for Friends and Family Day. I just wanted to sort of flag that next year, upcoming years, it's really helpful because people walk over and they go, oh, I got wetlands in my yard. And then I say, well, where do you live? You know, and so they could point it out on the map. And then they say, well, where's the conservation land? And I can say, well, it's over here. And they say, oh my gosh, I didn't even know there was a whole town forest. You know, people new to town tend to go to Friends and Family Day. So it was really, really good visual aid. So like I said, there's mostly people new to town talked about getting active in town, doing what they could to help conservation. The things they sounded interested in were more aligned with trails maintenance and town forest maintenance. So I unfortunately had to send them away. So it's a little bit of educating the public and telling them this is really what conservation does, is this. somebody on Summer Ave, I don't know if the family talked to you. They said their backyard is subsiding. What can be done about that? And I said, yeah, definitely get in touch with Chuck.
Is that Dave?
He called. He said Nika gave him permission to do filling and grading.
I did, but they can't prove it.
Is this the one that said they were neighbors with Becky?
No, no. Okay. They were closer to Main Street.
There's a lot of action on Summer Ave. There's at least two, plus maybe this one, so maybe three.
So they said they actually know, because of their house and how it's changing, that their actual basement, their foundation, is subsiding as well. So now, like, so they, and I said, do you have an official engineering opinion about that? And he said, well, my friend came over who is an engineer, and he definitely is. I said, well, you might need some, you know, you might need to submit a permit and get some official engineering, you know.
Trying to figure out which one.
So unfortunately, I think it's people new to Reading who went.
No, I came
to buy in Reading, where everything's wonderful, and like they're in like a slumping property situation. I wouldn't wish that. So unfortunately, we didn't get any selectmen visiting us. I think that's a shame. I think, you know, if they're out there and talking, they should be talking to all the booths. But, you know, what are you going to do? And next to me, my neighbor was the DPW, which was really helpful to me. I could chat about what are their protocols, what are their procedures, how do they get...
Oh, really?
Just a little bit.
She didn't go there expecting to be grilled by
the
Conservation
Commission.
You're like, oh, my God.
She had to work over the weekend.
No, maybe I'm overspeaking. It was more like, I said, so what do you do in town hall? And it was more like, you know, so how does DPW get stuff done?
How do you clean the swale?
What's the process?
How do you get permission to do it?
So, anyway. I took the booth down, the best part about Friends and Family Day is it's basically casual.
It's named correctly. Yeah.
It's casual, and people can have informal discussions, so, which is helpful.
So you did.
Yeah, so you do.
Who won Matera?
Well, we don't know yet. So I have here all the slips. People filled out little slips of paper to win.
Were they
win.
Able to fill the slips out, or was there some sort of, did you sell them like a plank of wood or something? Or
I'm not going to tell you what I sold. No. So we are giving away 4 hours of free use at Matera.
How many people we get to put names in there about?
You can count it when I'm done.
Looking for a ballpark.
There's 25 names, and there's three people that try.
Are there four Nika names?
I didn't put my name in. So, the winner. For all those watching, I know you're excited about this.
Allison Granera.
Okay. All right, Allison Granera, congratulations. You've just won 4 hours of free use.
I think that's late.
All right, great.
So that's it, thanks.
All right.
All right, good job, good job.
Yeah, thanks.
Boston Prep. We went out on Tuesday to look at the wetlands replication area. We walked along the area right adjacent to the existing wetland first, and noticed that they need to spread out the straw. They haven't done that. And then there's the stump that they said they were going to take out. They never did. But in the replication area itself, where they spread that or hydroseeded that seed mix, there's a real good coverage by herbaceous growth, not necessarily the woody plants that they planted, but there are carrots, there are sedges, there's skunk cabbage, jewel weed right next to the wetland that has, you know, migrated into that area, and also some cattails, some clumps of cattails.
Eastern white cedar.
No, this other stuff. I'm getting to that. Okay. in the low area, there were some swamp azaleas that they planted that survived. I guess there's some stinging nettle, but some of the other, like sweet fern, which I never thought would survive, did not survive.
Like Molly?
What?
I said that a little late, but it didn't survive. By golly.
Right, it didn't. And I called it when I first saw it. Along the edges, the slope, they planted. Oh, in the wetland, they planted four red maple. Three of them survived. One doesn't look so good. They planted several Atlantic white cedar. Only two marginally are surviving along the slope. There are three oaks that they planted. Two of them, which Dave pointed out, are planted next to the track. So if they grow large, they'll be dropping all kinds of things. So we suggested that they move those out. And there are some suggestions of replacement plants, such as buttonbush, in the low area for the woody stuff that didn't survive, and then on the slopes, silky dogwood. So those shrubs would be appropriate along the track area. What else? That's it.
There was erosion on the bank too.
Roundhouse turned and beat stepping on acorns on the track.
So
I said that to remove the.
Imagine that though.
No,
yeah.
The steep,
that would be bad.
The steep slope that leads to the replication area.
Yeah, there's some. Harvest Road, Clifford.
Clifford is a new. 14 Harvest Road had an oil leak. It was in a shed outside of the house next to the pool, and they saw the oil leak. They thought they caught it in time. It was less than 10 gallons, but they weren't lucky with this one because what they saw above ground. Led to some investigation, and the pipe had been leaking for a lot longer, so they had a huge excavation going, and they dug out everything next to the house, underneath where the shed was, and they were thinking about just pumping out the groundwater to try to get that oil out of the ground as it led to the brook that's right there on Tract Road. That's kind of where you are, Harvest and Tract. And I was asking them, geez, I don't, how long do you think that's going to take? Or it didn't seem, you're just going to keep chasing this until it comes out the other side and goes down into the brook. And so there was a little bit of discussion about that. And
who were we asking? The LSP?
It was an LSP. I had asked for some notes, but I had asked the LSP to get back in touch with us. And he did send me an email, which I don't have right now. But they ended up excavating about the same amount again up to the fence. So now they've taken out all the area where they think there's oil. But he understands he has to come in and file with us. So the extent of the excavation, he's probably within 15 feet of the bank, and he knows he wants to file to at least let the commission hear the project because this got well beyond 10 gallons and there was a lot of work done there. But his question is that should it be a notice of intent or should it be just an RDA? So
what are they
pretty much in these circumstances, we allow them to go ahead and get that stuff out of it. This is a true emergency. It needs to be handled as quickly as possible. We're after the fact. And sometimes being after the fact, it doesn't have to be a notice of intent. So it's up to the commission.
So what exactly are they proposing?
They're just proposing excavating. Were they proposing for a application?
In
how big of an excavation area?
25 by 50.
How deep?
7 feet. maybe. They had the house supported by jacks. They thought they undermounted the house by 2 feet. Building department had to go down there. Discuss that with them. There might be a portion of that oil that was underneath the hot tub, which they were, this hot tub out there, and they may be removing that just to explore that area a little bit too. But they had taken sidewall samples on that side that looked clean, but they didn't have the, you know, that was their visual kind of field thoughts. Back from the labs yet.
The area that they're excavating, was that previously grassed? Was it?
Grass, yeah.
You said 14 Harvest Road?
Yeah.
Okay.
So it was excavated and removed?
Yeah. So they take out all the soil, they take it away.
There's a hole in the yard right now, they don't know if this has to get basically.
There's a fence around it, but yeah. No, they would have kept going.
It doesn't have to get bigger, but they've got to.
They dug a 25-foot by 50-foot hole, 7 feet.
No. I didn't say 25. I said.
You said 25 by 50 by 7.
50 by 7.
Yeah.
That's what you said.
25.
Okay.
That's why we all went.
Are you sure not that
I would say
putting another foundation
it's
in?
10 to 12 feet wide, when I was there, and probably let's say 12 by 12, 5 to 7 foot deep. Called me on the phone. He said he ended up excavating this other spot, which would have been about the same amount. So that's why I had 25, but it's not 25 by 25. It's probably like 10 to 12 by 25.
Okay.
They're not getting groundwater, are they?
They were getting groundwater, and they were pumping it out into a tank.
To a frac tank.
So they had kind of a natural sparging operation going on.
Yeah. Yep.
So they collect it all? It's...
Well, I think that the groundwater, the tank was being filled up two or three times a day, and that led them to, they had to just start excavating more because they couldn't really manage that amount of water. So
but I guess my question is, they're staying inside the fence, though? I mean, they're staying on the property.
They're not near the bank within a foot, but they're probably within 5 feet of the bank, 5 to 7.
But they're not... not destabilizing the bank.
No.
They're not at risk of harming the bank.
Sure.
They've got to do what they've got to do. I say go ahead.
You've seen this. Do you think they need to come in with a notice of intent, or is an RDA going to be okay for the fix? I mean, I guess holding them till
these things are, this is really sometimes
sounds
just
like
an correct update works. Sometimes I don't think a notice of intent is needed. I think the LSP is in charge. If you feel confident with, and again, it's mostly an after the fact. We can't tell them not to do so. He's gonna end up doing what
he's got to do.
EP.
Yeah. He's got to be.
He thinks is best to clean
the MCP. So.
So I think an RDA would be good. I think that would work for me.
I have no problem with that.
Can we vote on that?
No, I'll just tell you.
You don't have to.
What's the groundwater level at, Chuck?
He said he was finding it at 5 feet, but what they did is they stuck a culvert, plastic culvert down in it. They dug it out. They stuck this culvert thing down in there, and then they put a pump down in that.
So, just mention to them. Maybe the LSP knows this. Maybe the LSP doesn't know this. There is a former DEP listed site at 13 Harvest Road.
Hmm.
So they may be treating their.
I don't.
They're pretty
that
far apart.
That was back from.
Yeah.
13 and 14 are far apart.
Well,
they're across the street from me.
They're across the street. That's going to be 200 feet.
Then why does 13 say? The figure says the property's here, the spill is here, and then there's bank and then street. I'll send you this document if you like.
So the one on 13 is like the side of the house, basically by the center, by the center of that house on 13 on the side. That's where the excavation was.
The same thing as an oil spill.
And the other ones basically say so. From this, the distance that I'm trying to say is from the center of each house is how far those two spills are apart, plus a road in between.
Okay.
they both on Harvest?
Yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, we actually
it's from 2006.
Issued a certificate of compliance for that 13 Harvest earlier this year for that job.
But I, if the LSP, may
yeah.
not know that.
I'll let
and
them know.
May be interested in knowing.
That's a good point. All right.
Do we have an MACC bill?
We do. We have a bill from MACC for our dues, and it's for $732.
I move for, do we have the budget?
We have it in the budget.
Oh, good. I move we approve the bill.
Second.
All those in favor? There are no minutes for approval. Oh, I know. It's that time of year again.
Oh, I thought that's what you were saying. Clear the slate, so.
Oh.
It's that time of year again where we have to reappoint or appoint officers for the commission, chair, vice chair. And I am happy to continue as chair if you want me to. If you don't, say it now.
I think you've been doing a great job. I'll nominate to reappoint you.
Second.
All those in favor.
So then now it's the vice chair.
I'm happy to play that role. It hasn't been very active lately, or maybe I haven't been available. That's that look. But if anybody else is interested, all right, hearing none, I'll boldly step forward.
Really? I thought there would be more people stepping up.
I know.
I don't know. Maybe we're in more.
What do you mean? This is your last meeting.
You didn't hurry up.
I'm up.
You've done your time and you're out.
I know Mike's having a. Mike's gonna be busy.
Yeah, not the right time for me to move. Anika, I make a motion to nominate Anika.
A second. All those in favor.
Excellent.
Smooth. So, Al, why didn't you
read up? I'm busy. That's why I missed the last few meetings. I'm too busy for this.
So, you're telling us you've got better things to do now on a Tuesday night?
Huh?
You've got better things to do now on a Tuesday night?
Wait a minute.
I'll second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Awesome.
Well, thanks for doing your time, Al.